Welcome to the Alex Jones Show on this Monday, August 3rd, 2015. I'm your host, David Knight. Alex Jones is going to be joining us live in the next segment from Europe. We have a large show today in terms of news. Starting with economic news, after a five-week shutdown, the Greek stock market has come back, and it's come back with a 23% decline. They say this has been shut down for 5 weeks. Of course, one fund manager is describing it as herd behavior, herd mentality. People are very concerned as to what's happening in Greece, and with good reason. It's not just a overreaction. I'm surprised that it didn't fall any farther than that. And of course, Alex is in Europe looking at the economic takedown, the planned economic takedown of the European nations, especially the ones in the periphery, Portugal, Italy, Ireland, Greece, Spain. He's going to Spain, and we're going to have some reports later in the program because you're very limited as to what you can say about Spain when you're in Spain. They have enacted a true Spanish Inquisition when it comes to freedom of the press. It's just been reenacted. They were prevented from taking pictures in public that would normally be things that would show up on Google Streets Map. They were intimidated. They had their film erased. Of course, that already happens here in the United States. If you go in front of a Federal Reserve office building, you can very easily have that happen to you here in the United States. And that kind of tyranny is expanding everywhere. But they're seeing it the worst in these peripheral states of the European Union. Now, in other news, especially financial news from Europe, we have our first criminal conviction of an individual manipulating the LIBOR exchange rates. These are the London Interbank Exchange rates that interest rates everywhere are based on. Whenever you buy a car, you buy a house, those interest rates are based on LIBOR. You've probably seen that when you got your loan, especially if you were looking at a variable rate loan. You know that that's constantly indexed to the LIBOR exchange. We had massive fines by our perspective against UBS and Citigroup, although from their perspective, in terms of the money that these people make for money laundering, for rigging the markets, they were slaps on the wrist. The large amounts, when you look at these billion-dollar fines, you say, well, that's a lot of money. Not when you're making the kind of money that they are. It's a very small percentage of their earnings. Yes, crime does pay. Bank robbery does pay when you're at the bank and you're robbing other people. Now, this is the first individual who's been convicted of a crime. He was charged with 8 counts of conspiracy to defraud. He was convicted on all of those counts. One of the interesting things about it, the Wall Street Journal points out, is that in 2013, he entered an agreement to cooperate, to plead guilty, to testify against his alleged co-conspirators. Part of that process, he gave 82 hours of taped interviews to investigators in which he repeatedly admitted that he had acted dishonestly, and they used that against him. Apparently, there's no honor among thieves, government thieves or banker thieves. Here's another thief, John Boehner, somebody that ought to go to jail, but the best we can do probably is just get him out of the speakership. Remember, we talked about last week how one of the congressmen from North Carolina, Mark Meadows, had just had it with Boehner. He'd had it with the thuggish regime that would penalize people if they didn't do everything that Boehner demanded. And of course, Republicans, especially grassroots Republicans, Republican voters, feel and are betrayed by what Boehner and McConnell have done after that last election. Voters gave the GOP a majority in both the Senate and the House, expecting that they would do something about the issues that they had campaigned on, like open border, Obamacare. They have done nothing. They basically just thumbed their nose at the voters. So a lot of people are angry with good reason at John Boehner. We just saw with these videos coming out, he couldn't muster any concern whatsoever about these Planned Parenthood videos. Now, in this particular case, what's interesting about this is that they'd intended to bring this up and just shut this down, said, oh, there's nothing to this. This guy, Mark Meadows, doesn't have any support. They were going to shut that down, and then they started calling around, and they found out, ooh, we might lose this vote. Very interesting. We might have an option here to get Boehner out. Stay with us. We're going to be right back. Alex Jones will be joining us live from Europe.
We are live, ladies and gentlemen. Thank you so much for joining us on this Monday worldwide transmission. I am your host, Alex Jones. We're going to be co-hosting today with David Knight, who is in Austin, Texas. I have met the Pantheon built in 126 AD, or basically 1,800 plus years ago. This is the only Roman original structure that wasn't destroyed. That's because in 410, about 200 plus years after this was built, close to 300, when the Germans took over, the German barbarians, their leader Alaric, marched in through those doors. I'm going to take you in there in a moment. With a live feed, if you're watching on TV, I'll describe it for radio listeners. And he thought, this must be the house of the gods. They burned and destroyed everything else, all the fantastical stuff here. So imagine the city's on fire, women are all being raped, their men are being killed. Major parallels to what's happening in the United States. We come to you live, broadcasting worldwide. And I just went in and taped a whole special report that's going to air tomorrow, where I did a whole tour. It's 10 minutes long. We're going to add some images to it. That'll be on the radio/TV show tomorrow, tying it into all the historical parallels. We're going to be going to the Vatican. It's openly calling for world government now with the new pope. We're going to be talking to people on the street, so much more. Rob Dew's here with us. He's off doing some shoots right now. I've got Buckley Hammond, my cousin, running camera for us. But I wanted to go over the news that's currently at Infowars.com as we sit here at this historic site in the middle of Rome here in Italy. If you go to Infowars.com, you'll see a chilling article from Reuters. And it's like they're talking about the price of a new F-150, or it's like they're talking about, you know, the weather. It's just real nonchalant. Oh, Obama has announced that we're going to start bombing Syria with the U.S. Air Force and NATO anytime Syria fights the rebels. Well, the Pentagon admits 90%+ of the rebels are al-Qaeda, are ISIS. And it was 2.5 years ago that our own military said, we will not fight for al-Qaeda. And they put out the thousands of tweets with officers holding up signs, covering their faces, saying, I don't want to be in the Air Force for al-Qaeda. I didn't sign up to be part of a Syrian civil war. Syria has done nothing to us. We just destroyed 5 years ago Libya. Now they admit it's a failed state, worse than ever, a base for al-Qaeda and ISIS. And now they're saying that, just like, it's no big deal, no big fanfare this time, no building a case, no making up chemical weapons attacks like they got caught doing before that the al-Qaeda, Saudi Arabian rebels launched. No, now, ladies and gentlemen, we're told that it's just, oh, if Syria fights the rebels, we're going to bomb them. This is incredible. Supposedly it starts next week. So they won't bomb ISIS, taking over Iraq, taking over Libya, taking over areas of Africa, attacking the West, attacking France. Obama said missiles and bombs are not the answer for them because that's their Saudi Arabian proxy army. But it is the answer if Syria fights back against these people. They've killed over 300,000 Syrians in the last 5 years. They've blown up almost every church in the country. They are murdering the non-radical Muslims. This is a serious war crime by the evil people that run our government. The people that run our government harvest babies' organs, keep the babies alive to harvest the organs. That's all coming out. We have corrupt federal judges, in my view, that come out and say there's a gag order on this. It's a state secret. Well, the truth's already out. And so it just shows we have pure, unmitigated, unadulterated evil. How long did I tell you that they sell baby parts? That's really what it's all about. It's been out there for a long time. Now these videos are coming out. So no matter what the globalists try, this is coming out. Let's go walk around a little bit here. We have all these cultures, all these histories, and humans repeat themselves over and over again throughout history. We only live on average 75 years. We act the same. We behave the same. The same type of con artists over and over again are able to take over, and then we start this cycle again of rebirth, getting rid of them. Well, the technocrats this time believe that they're going to be able to successfully... You don't need to show me, Buckley. You can show folks incredible sights. Thanks. The technocrats think they're going to outsmart human instinct this time that always overturns the tyrant. This is the type of insanity we're talking about. And there are so many other countless articles that are completely over the top at Infowars.com. And it's all done by design to basically break our will and to condition us to accept anything and everything. And Rome tried to put the public on welfare, ended up making the Romans so weak, they finally fell to outsiders. In fact, Rome, starting in the time of Julius Caesar, was 50-something B.C., began to bring people in to the country to be voting blocks who would then outvote the Roman citizens. They began to make foreigners basically citizens.
Good boy. How you doing?
Good, man. We got this guy dressed up in a Roman outfit here, pretending like he was stabbing Buckley. So here we go. into the Pantheon as I give you this breakdown. We have a detailed breakdown coming up tomorrow. It's just so wild to see world government openly being announced, and then to hear the media saying it doesn't exist, hear the media saying it doesn't matter, and that everybody should just basically accept it. But the good news is people are waking up. The problem is that we've got an awake population. We've run into so many Romans that are awake here in Italy. But then they ask, what do we do? Well, you wake others up, you stop complying with the system, you vote with your euros, you vote with your dollars. Now, we're crossing the threshold of the Pantheon right now, if you're a TV viewer, if you're a radio listener, Infowars.com/show. And when Alaric, the leader of the hordes out of Germanium, the Visigoth chieftain, marched in here, this is the only building they didn't ransack or burn because they thought this must be the temple of the gods. Now it's a church. But then it was also a Christian church. Previously, it had been a pagan temple. And if you look up, this is what so many modern domes are based on. Has the big hole in the ceiling. Just simply amazing. So this is what Infowars.com is all about. Those that don't know history are doomed to repeat it. So we're here trying to get people to think about what's happening, trying to get people to understand. I mean, this is the very floor that was here in 126 AD after the death of Christ. This is the original floor in here with the red marble on the white, with the gold marble on the red. Simply incredible. Now, look, there's so many other articles at Infowars.com. We've got a special report coming up. We were just in Spain, and we went to Valencia because we knew that there was a beautiful art city. We went to Valencia because we knew that they had a bizarre science museum with beautiful architecture that's dedicated to eugenics. And whenever we got there, Rob New has the report that's coming up. He's trying to upload it right now from the hotel. Hopefully it'll be ready today, if not tomorrow. And it was based on eugenics and was very proud of it. You see, Spain's the only country that was fascist in World War II that didn't get in trouble for it. They claim they were neutral during the war, but actually Edward VIII, the Nazi king of England, was able to escape out of Germany into Spain. Franco was a fascist on record, and so they were the only fascist country not to fall, and they basically have continued so much of what they're doing to this day. And the reason we focus on eugenics is that's the real religion of the elite. But they're not just trying to, quote, get rid of the infirm and the problem people like they claim. And that wouldn't be good either. It's always is a hurting innocent people. It's just you can't pick and choose life like that. They're really targeting the informed. They're really targeting people that they call bad sons or folks that would be rivals to what they're doing. So it's an attack on intellect. It's an attack on civilization. Some of the stuff in here predates the Christian takeover. And up here you can see the big fascist eagle, so much of what modern Washington D.C. iconography. And logos, and symbolism is based on, and it's holding a bundle of sticks in its feet, meaning all the countries that it's been able to conquer and on the broadcast. But the good news is we're not bragging when we say this. We have been basically stopped every couple minutes by listeners from all over the world, Germany, France, England, right here in Italy, right here in Rome. And so it's very, very exciting to see all of this happening, to see people aware of what's going on. And that's why we've built the InfoWars operation now with our reporters and more reporters. Hopefully we're going to be able to hire so we can always have someone, whether it's Japan or Russia or Africa, or in independent countries, documenting what's happening and really showing people context. This is all unedited live, no teleprompter. Nobody else does this in the media. Nobody does this in talk radio. This is what it's really all about, showing we've got the intel, showing we've got the data. We're going to go to break in a moment, and I'm going to throw it to David Knight. Again, I'll be co-hosting more with live shows throughout this week, and then I'll be back, Lord willing, next Sunday for the syndicated transmission. But this is what it's all about. This is what we're trying to do. And this is what you have helped build, is one of the only true independent media operations that's pro-human, pro-liberty, pro-Renaissance, and is aware of what's happening and what's going on. So Infowars.com will continue to report. I want to just say the crew's been doing a great job this week, as always. David Knight doing an amazing job. It's so fulfilling to be on a train or getting on a plane to be able to listen to the free iPhone app. That's so fulfilling to have police nod and say InfoWars and to have customs know who we are, here in Italy and to say that they're listeners. It is so truly invigorating and exciting to see this. But there is a lot of bad happening as well. We're here exposing it. But that's why they want to shut down the independent media, because we can expose Planned Parenthood. We can have these victories. We can expose Monsanto. They don't like it. We can break the left-right paradigm. I'm going to throw this back to David Knight. More special reports coming. It's going to be jam-packed as we're here in Rome reporting on the globalist takeover. We're going to the Vatican next. We're going to expose that incredible situation with the Pope calling for world government and carbon taxes. Man on the street, it's all coming up. Alex Jones throwing it back to David Knight and the InfoWars.com News Center in Austin, Texas.
And again, that's Alex Jones in Rome. And when we come back, we're going to look at not only Obama bombing Syria, literally, but he is going to bomb our economy metaphorically using the EPA. Stay with us. We'll be right back. And joining us again from Rome is Alex Jones. Go ahead, Alex.
David, I'm going to get out of here and let you get to all the important news. But I just wanted to point out that for as negative as the globalists are, human achievement, human development is limitless and amazing because we're made in the image of God. We hadn't eaten in about 5-6 hours. There's a little cafe where we just got some pizza here together. Buckley Hammond and his wife over here, my good friend. Should we say your name there? All right. There's Miranda Hammond. And she's on the trip with us, doing a great job. And we're just here at the Pantheon. We've been out shooting reports all day long. And this is something humans built almost 2,000 years ago that they can't even reconstruct as good today. And look at the pyramids and just look at mathematics and look at science. We're a very special species. And the globalists are basically threatened by us. That's why they're demonizing us all day long. So when we talk about the bad stuff in the world, it's not that we're being negative. We're defending the good from the bad. I mean, look at this great culture of Italy being taken over by the globalists right now, being looted like they've done in Greece with all their tax increases. Look at how we still have things so good and this overabundance because our forebears weren't wimps and stood up for freedom, just like in the United States. So that's what it comes down to. And I'm very thankful and humble to the listeners for their support and what we're all able to do to really shift people out of the trance they're in and just look at the wider world that is around everyone. So from myself to the larger viewing audience and listening audience out there, this is history that is taking place right now. And we can turn the tide against what's happening. That's the news I want to break down. But we have to value humanity again. We have to value freedom again. We have to value family again. We have to realize how outrageous it is. There's an attack on the institution of men and women loving each other and being together, and the state and the media trying to get people fighting with each other and to get in the middle of that. I mean, how sick is this? How sick is it that one of our main exports is the baby parts now? How sick is it that we put up with all this garbage? Wake up out of the trance, break the paradigm, come together, humanity, realize that we do have amazing potential, and the globalists fear that. All right, David, a ton of reports coming up. Fabulous job. Thank you so much, my friend.
Thank you, Alex. And as Alex mentioned, he's in Rome. They're going to be going to the Vatican. And, of course, very shortly, the Pope is going to be coming to America. He's going to be selling an agenda. And we see part of this agenda and the effect of this and some regulations that came out yesterday. You know, Alex mentioned that Obama is stepping up the war in Syria, stepping up the bombing there. At the same time, saying it's a humanitarian mission, but they give their Saudi proxies free reign to bomb massive numbers of civilians in Yemen. Nevertheless, they're going to step up the bombing. We're going to report on that and some of the other things that are happening there. Of course, that's been going on for a while. There's also reports of British soldiers who are there, SAS soldiers in Syria, dressed as ISIS. We're going to talk about that. But Obama is also bombing the U.S. economy, metaphorically, using the EPA. Just yesterday, we found that Obama has proposed, and I'm not sure if this is just a proposal or if it will be an imposition of these EPA regulations, That's going to, we're going to have to see exactly how that works. Of course, there'll have to be some court fights. We'll actually have to have someone in Congress to fight this. I don't know if there's any will for that or not. Obama is proposing new regulations that are far more stringent than they were in the past. This is an article on Infowars.com. Obama's climate fascism is another nail in the coffin for the U.S. economy. Is he really trying to kill the economy on purpose? Well, yes, he is. Quite frankly, cheap energy is the basis not only for our living standard, it's the basis for our life expectancy. He's trying to kill not only our lifestyle, he's trying to kill us. Understand, when the Pope takes on this climate change agenda, when he starts promoting this and ignoring what is going on with Planned Parenthood, have you heard anything from the Pope about this? No, you haven't. Did you hear anything about the massive sea change in marriage, the regulations here? No. These are two things that have been the bedrock of Catholicism, the family, life, standing in opposition to abortion. Totally silent on these issues. Yet he's pushing global governance on the basis of man-made climate change. Along with Prince Charles, along with Obama, he's joining in with scientists like Schellenhuber, who he appointed to the Vatican Scientific Advisory Council. Someone who has promoted massive depopulation. And one way that you can achieve massive depopulation is with expensive, unaffordable energy. It destroys our lifestyle. It destroys our lives. It destroys our economy. We're going to take a look at these regulations when we come back. We're going to take a look at what's going on in Syria. And we're going to take a look at the horse race aspect. They're off. And tonight, we have the first debate. It's not Thursday, but it's tonight in New Hampshire. We're going to tell you about that when we come back as well. Stay with us. Welcome back to the Alex Jones Show on this Monday, August 3rd, 2015. Alex Jones just joined us live from Rome in the previous segment, so we're going to have some special reports from him coming up, especially some reports from Spain, because there's not much that they could say about Spain while they were in Spain. Isn't that interesting? America's getting like that, too, as I pointed out. But he will be joining us with some special reports later in the program. I wanted to point out that, you know, we've had free shipping through the month of July. We really didn't push that until the last week or so. We put it up there. It was on the website. We really didn't tell people that much about the free shipping. That ended on Friday, but Alex called this weekend, decided to extend the free shipping one more week this week. Some people are on vacation. We wanted to do this as a thank you to people that did not know about the free shipping. So you can still get throughout this week free shipping on everything that we sell at InfoWarsLife.com. All of our products there. One of the products that's in stock, frequently is out of stock, is Survival Shield X2 Nascent Iodine. If you go to our site there, InfoWarsLife.com, you can see there's over 400 reviews. Over 99% of those are positive. They would recommend it to a friend or family member. Here's a couple of those reviews. We got one from Faded Holy Soldier in Katy, Texas. It says, within a week of taking nascent iodine, my moods were better. I had more energy in the morning. It made me feel more upbeat, happier in the morning. This is the real deal iodine. I love products from InfoWars. Thank you, Alex. You have no idea how much you changed my life for the better. God bless you, brother. Another one from Joseph Jenkins in Dallas, Texas. He says, honestly, I've never felt this good and clean inside out. I have tried dozens of other products, but these from InfoWars are dead on and produce dramatic results in good ways. God bless and keep your head down, Info Soldiers. So that's one of the things that we do to support our operation. We could do commercials, we could ask for donations. What Alex has done, and I think it's a good thing, is to offer high-quality products that will help you to take control of your life, to take control of your health. You can find those at InfoWarsLife.com. And through this week, we have extended free shipping on everything in the store. Now, going back to the articles that we were talking about to the break, teasing what was coming up, of course, Obama is extending and increasing the war in Syria. He is also extending and increasing the war against our economy here in the U.S. We have new regulations that are being proposed by the Obama administration, by the EPA. On Sunday, we learned that Obama is imposing a nationwide 32% carbon dioxide emission reduction from 2005 levels by the year 2030. When it was first proposed last year, Obama's plan called for a 30% reduction. He's up that now to 35. Why not? You know, it's good to be the king. You can just make these arbitrary reductions. We need to have a discussion as to whether or not this is real. And we're going to talk about that in just a moment. Is this a real threat or is this an agenda by some globalist factions for global governance, for a global tax to have a planetary council, as the Vatican's scientific advisor has said, Schellenhuber. This is what we see coming. But let's talk about these regulations that are before us right now. They say the final version is even more dramatic. It's gone up from 30%. They say the Obama administration admits this is going to cost the U.S. economy billions of dollars a year, and that electricity rates for many Americans are going to rise substantially. Again, there was an article yesterday from the AP saying Obama to order steeper cuts for power plants. Power prices will undoubtedly rise as POTUS shuts down power plants. Understand, this is going to dramatically affect the economy in many ways. It's not just the price of electricity. It's going to have a multiplying effect. It's like a VAT tax. Everybody that uses energy in any way, shape, or form is going to be affected by that, and that's everybody. And it's a cumulative effect. It goes into the products, not just the air conditioning that you use. This is a way to take down our economy, to create an economic crisis, because it always serves a government that wants to expand its reach. One person who's furious about this, and this came out last week, we had this on InfoWars, a furious CEO of a coal company lets it all out. He says, Obama is the nation's great destroyer. Yes, this is about destroying our economy. This is about lowering our life expectancy, quite frankly, not just our lifestyle. Murray Energy CEO Robert Murray spoke to Republicans at a dinner. He said, Mr. Obama's actions are a human issue to me, as I know the names of many of the Americans whose jobs and family livelihoods are being destroyed. He said, these Americans are my employees, or at least they were his employees. Murray laid off 21% of his company back in May. The majority of the cuts came in West Virginia, which is staring down a $195 million budget gap thanks to the slide in coal prices. You remember Obama had said when he was running for office that he was going to destroy the coal industry. This isn't somebody's projecting what his motivations are. He clearly stated that he was going to destroy the coal industry. Why? Well, it's not because it's dirty. We've got old power plants, but they don't want any coal power plants. They want to destroy all of them because they are obsessed on CO2. We'll get to that in a moment. But he went on to say, Obama administration has issued regulations that illegally bypass the states and their utility commissions and the U.S. Congress and the Constitution. Do you understand this? Do you understand how important this is? This is like the war on drugs in the sense that we are completely destroying our legal structure, our rule of law for these different agendas. We can talk about the agendas. We can talk about carbon dioxide, and we can talk about whether there is man-made global warming. We can talk about how we should stop drug use. What's the most effective way to approach people with that? I'm not supporting drug use. I am opposed to prohibition, and I am opposed to extra legal tactics that are being taken for this agenda as well as any other agenda for that matter. But again, he's bypassing the states, he's bypassing the state utility commissions, he's bypassing the Congress, he's bypassing the Constitution. We see this over and over again from the Obama administration. He's going to put the EPA in charge of the nation's electric grid. That's precisely what's going to happen here. He continued and he said, coal workers affected by Obama's policies are among the highest paid in the regions where they live. But they also have no one to sell their homes to when they lose their jobs. Thus, these people are prohibited from working, and they fall to the negative side of the economic ledger for the rest of their lives. You understand that. They can't sell their homes. They're the highest paid workers in the area. These are guys who work hard, who do dangerous work, and they're highly compensated. And Obama is going to shut this down because America has more coal than the Middle East has oil. And we can't have America being energy sufficient. We can't have Americans have cheap energy. No, we have to destroy America. He says these people are going to be prohibited from working the rest of their lives, fall to the negative economic side of the ledger. He says, this is not the America I have always cherished. I am obviously not going to give up, nor should you. We have law, science, economics, cold, hard energy facts, and the Constitution on our side. Let's talk about some of those facts that are on our side. This is something from Stephen Goddard, his blog at WordPress.com. Mind-blowing temperature fraud at NOAA. That's the National Oceanic and Atmospheric Administration. The measured U.S. temperature data from the USHCN, that's a subdivision of NOAA, we'll talk about who they are in just one moment, shows that the U.S. is on a long-term cooling trend. But the reported temperatures from NOAA show a strong warming trend. What's up about this? Well, it's called data tampering. They corrupt the U.S. temperature trend by almost 2 degrees. And he shows the charts here on his blog. Now, there's a couple of different things that they're doing. They're tampering with the raw data. And you can see this one chart right here. If we're looking at this, this is a how they have manipulated the final versus the raw data. So that's how they're plugging it right there. You can see that on the screen. That is increasing. And they say here, the biggest component of the fraud, however, is making up data. Almost half of all reported U.S. temperature data is now fake. They fill in the missing rural data with urban data to create the appearance of non-existent U.S. warming. Now, the next chart that we have here is the percentage of USHCN final data, which is fake, 50%. What's going on? Why does he say this data is fake? Let's talk about who USHCN is. That is the United States Historical Climatology Network, a high-quality data set, they say, this is their self-description, a high-quality data set of daily and monthly records of basic meteorological variables from 1,218 observation stations across the 48 contiguous United States. Daily data include observations of maximum and minimum temperature, precipitation amounts, snowfall amounts, snow depth, all the sorts of things you would expect for weather. Now, this is, they say, while some of the National Weather Service's first order stations are, they say, many of these are located in rural locations, while some are often located in an urbanized environment. And that's what he's talking about. When their data doesn't fit the conclusion that they want, they skew it to the urbanized data. Now, let me ask you, where do you think you're going to get higher temperatures? In the rural areas where there's trees, or on a thermometer set up on an airport runway, or on a thermometer in the middle of an urban area? I can tell you from experience, when we lived in North Carolina, we lived probably about 20, 30 miles outside of Raleigh in a community called Pittsboro. Raleigh is not a big city, but it does have a lot of roads. It does have concrete and that sort of thing. But we would consistently see, as we watched the temperature on our car's thermometer, we would consistently see about a 3 to 4 degree temperature differential when we left from Raleigh and went into the area where we lived that was heavily forested. You can get radical changes in temperature if you skew your data by looking at urbanized weather stations and ignoring the rural weather stations. That's why many people have talked about, look at the weather taken by satellite as a much better measure of what's going on here. And we know that the data is being rigged. We've seen this with climate change. You remember with Climate Gate, I should say. We've seen this with the Climate Gate scandals. There was the first scandal where there were 1,000 emails that came out. That originally happened in the UK, in East Anglia University. People wanted to look at the original information that they had. There were emails going back and forth saying that, well, this isn't matching our models. We have to manipulate the data to make it fit our models. So a lot of people were suspicious of that. Some people tried to bring that to light. They were shut down. They would not let people see that information. Does that sound familiar? Isn't that the way all of our governments in the West are now operating? Everything is secret. We're not allowed to see anything, especially the raw data that they're using to base these climate change predictions on. And so after much legal wrangling back and forth, 1,000 emails showed up mysteriously on a Russian server that were very incriminating. Well, they came back and they downplayed that, just like the White House is doing with these Planned Parenthood videos. But the emails were very explicit. I think they were very damning, very incriminating. But they ignored it. They continued with what they were doing at the Climate Center at East Anglia University. And then a few years later, there was a second Climate Gate. They released this time not 1,000, but 5,000 emails showing the same thing. Again, completely ignored by the mainstream press, just as we've seen with the Planned Parenthood videos or with other aspects of things that they do not want to expose because of their political agenda. We tried in the United States to get emails from the University of Virginia from Michael Mann, the guy who created the hockey stick. We tried to get those emails made public. Again, they were paid for by the public. They were paid for with research that was funded by the government at a public university. These were emails that were written while they were on the job. These were emails and data that were used for their conclusions that were then used for public policy, just like Obama's increasing carbon taxes on us. Well, they're not carbon taxes, but in a way it is an increase when you say you're going to force the reduction of emissions. But of course, we're not allowed to see those things, so they just merrily go along with this. The only thing I can say, the only hope that we have, apparently, is that these climate alarmists are telling us that Washington, D.C. is going to sink into the ocean. The sooner, the better. The only problem is, they say it's going to take another 100 years for that to happen. So instead of the Rome on the Potomac, eventually we're going to have a Venice on the Potomac, if they're correct. And they're not correct. This is simply a scheme to allow people like Al Gore to essentially set up indulgences for every time you use energy. This has been a scheme by the globalists for quite some time. They have manipulated our money with a fiat currency, and now that's not good enough. What they want to do is they want to go directly to manipulating the hardcore control by controlling our energy use. Let's take a look at what's going on in a physical war. There's an article up on Infowars.com. Homeland Security is idle on a 2008 EMP threat. They say government dysfunction is preventing us from protecting ourselves. Well, maybe that's it. Maybe the government just can't get its act together to come up and do something about a possible threat from EMP. We've talked about what that would involve in many cases. Of course, it could be something like a Carrington event, which we have seen in the past, a massive solar flare that does an electromagnetic pulse that takes out the grid. There was, at the time, that they call it the Carrington effect, because when that happened in the 1800s, I think it was the 1800s. Anyway, when it happened, there was massive effect on that. It is a natural phenomenon, but it can also be something like an exploding nuclear bomb in the upper atmosphere, creating an electromagnetic pulse. It has the potential to take down the grid. If you take down the grid, people are going to die. There's going to be mass chaos if the grid goes down. We have a just-in-time delivery system. We have a very, very thin lines of supply in this country. Now, they say, according to experts, the minimum needed to protect American power grids from an EMP would involve no more than a few hundred substations that could be hardened for an estimated $100,000 per station. Only $100,000 for a few hundred stations. A paltry sum. A paltry sum, absolutely. You're talking about tens of millions of dollars here. Compared to other technological costs borne by Homeland Security, by law enforcement, by military agencies, understand, our military budget is more than half of the entire federal budget. Our military budget is more than all of the rest of the world's military budget combined. So when you're talking about tens of millions of dollars, that's nothing. Why won't they do anything about it? Well, I'll tell you why I think. I don't think that they really care about defending us. They could do something very effective, very cheaply. I don't think they care. There isn't any reason for them to do it because there's not enough profit in it. Maybe because it's only tens of millions of dollars, they just can't get interested in the military-industrial complex because they deal in profits of many, many billions of dollars. That's all they're interested in. So first of all, they can't make enough money doing something about it. And in the second place, there's absolutely no spoils to be had because it isn't something they can use for war or use to control the population. But let's look at what's going on in Syria. And of course, years ago, we had Wesley Clark talking about how he had been told that they had a list of countries that they were going to go into. And of course, Syria was one of those on the list. They say U.S. jets, this is a story at Infowars.com, U.S. jets to begin striking Syrian forces if they target pro-U.S. rebels. Actually, this has been going on for quite some time. Stay with us. When we come back, we're going to talk about how this has been going on for a long time. We're also going to talk about special forces disguising themselves as ISIS fighters in Syria. Stay with us. We'll be right back. In the last segment, we were talking about the U.S. is going to begin stepping up Syrian airstrikes. They say if they're going to be fighting pro-U.S. rebels. We're going to talk about what's behind that. We're going to talk about the fact that the U.S. has been involved in massive airstrikes on ISIS targets for quite some time. not very effective militarily, but very effective in terms of collateral damage that's gone on there, just like the Saudi bombing campaign in Yemen. So we're going to get back to that in just one moment. Real briefly, we have extended free shipping for one more week. We have a lot of people we know that are on vacation during the summer. As a thank you to our supporters, to our listeners, we've extended free shipping on all the products at InfoWarsLife.com for one more week. We also have a special on Silver Bullet. You can buy two Silver Bullet, get two free. So right now, while it's in stock, is a good time to stock up on that, as well as things like nascent iodine that are good for your preparedness cupboard. And this is a good time to do it, especially with free shipping and while they are in stock. Again, 50% off Silver Bullet. Buy two, get two free. That's our 30 parts per million colloidal silver. A good time to stock up. That's at InfoWarsLife.com. Now, getting back to this article, they say U.S. jets are going to begin striking Syrian forces if they target pro-U.S. rebels. This is from Reuters. This is from today. They say the U.S. has decided to allow airstrikes to defend Syrian rebels trained by the U.S. military from any attackers, even if the enemies hail from forces loyal to Syrian President Bashar Assad, U.S. officials said on Sunday. Even if they're Syrian officials. Give me a break. The whole point of this, for years, they have been targeting, trying to start a war with Assad. We saw this in 2013. They were doing the phony nerve gas stuff that we exposed. Many people exposed it. They backed down with that. They were going to do an outright invasion. You had McCain going over meeting with these Al-Qaeda people, with these ISIS leaders. They created ISIS there in Syria. And now ISIS has spilled over into Iraq. They have been doing everything they can to take down Syria, to foment a rebellion there, to engage a war. And because they couldn't get a war declared, now they're saying, well, we're going to go to the defense of pro-U.S. rebels. These would be the ISIS fighters. To underscore this, there is a report from RT about special forces from the UK disguised as ISIS fighters who are already operating in Syria. They say special forces from Britain's most shadowy military unit are dressing as Islamic State militants, traveling deep in the badlands of Syria to track and destroy enemy assets, according to military sources. Why not dress like them? We equip them, we fund them, we train them, we're going to provide air support for them. Remember when we had this debate a couple of years ago when they had this phony sarin gas attack and we had multiple people in Congress, Rand Paul, others. We had, Dennis Kucinich, Democrat, talking about how we don't want to be Al-Qaeda's Air Force. Well, now we're going to be Al-Qaeda's Air Force. If they target pro-U.S. rebels, who do you think the pro-U.S. rebels are there? It's the ISIS, Al-Qaeda people that John McCain was meeting with. They say it's reported that up to two SAS squadrons of men, about 120 personnel, are operating inside the borders of Syria as part of Operation Shader. So are we providing air support for these covert Western forces who are dressed as ISIS rebels? Are we providing air support for the ISIS rebels themselves, for Al-Qaeda? It doesn't matter, does it? We just want a war. We want more war. Think about that when we come up to this presidential election. Think about, if you're a Democrat, how you were pwned by Obama. You thought you were voting for somebody that was going to reduce the wars, that was going to shut down Gitmo. Think again. And Republicans need to think hard about what's going on as well. Welcome back to the Alex Jones Show. It's Monday, August 3rd, 2015. I'm David Knight, your host today. In the next segment, we're going to talk about the beginnings of the presidential horse race as it's about to begin. Actually, it begins tonight, not even this next Thursday. Tonight, there is going to be a debate in New Hampshire. There's going to be quite a few participants, 14 GOP candidates. Although Donald Trump will not be there, a couple others like Huckabee will not be there. The vast majority of them will be there. We're going to talk about the horse race when we come back. This segment, I would like to read you something that Norman Lear said. And of course, this is from Entertainment Weekly. He was addressing an association in the Television Critics Association in Beverly Hills. And of course, Norman Lear is the guy who produced All in the Family, The Jeffersons, many big hit shows. I guess they were back in, what, the 70s? Yeah, it was the 70s, I think. I got to think back a while. It's been a long time since I watched television. So I guess it was in the 70s. Anyway, this is what he had to say about politics. This is the Drudge Report had a link to this. It might still be up. He says, everybody knows me to be a progressive or a liberal or a lefty or whatever. I think of myself as a bleeding heart conservative. You will not F with my Bill of Rights, my Constitution, my guarantees of political justice for all. But does my heart bleed for those who need help, who aren't getting the justice that this country promises them, the equal opportunity that the country promises? Yes, he says. I'm a bleeding heart, but I think myself to be a total social conservative. The people who are running just don't seem to have America on their mind. Not the America I think about. When I was a kid, we were in love with America. As early as I can remember, there were civics classes in my public school. I was in love with those things that guaranteed freedom. Before I learned that there were people who hated me because I was Jewish. This is Norman Mailer. He said, I had a Bill of Rights. I had a Constitution. Those words out of the Declaration of Independence that protected me. And I knew that because we had civics in class. We don't have that much in the country anymore. So before World War II or shortly later, we were in love with America because we understood what it was about. And that's what we were in love with. And I believe he's, I think I saw somewhere in here, it's been a couple of days since I looked at this article. I think he was 93 on Monday. Let me tell you something. Yeah, he's exactly right. Our children are not taught in the government's schools about the Bill of Rights. They're not taught that they have dignity as an individual. They're not taught that they possess certain rights inherently. As an individual, that's what the Declaration of Independence was about. That's what our country was about. They're not talking about that anymore. Today, we have school systems that are set up with a Brave New World curriculum, sexualizing our children at a very early age, totally sexualizing them. We forget about the Bill of Rights. We teach cops to shoot first. I'm not 93. I'm far from 93, but this is not the America I grew up in. This is not the America I want to be a part of. This is not the America I want my children, my grandchildren to live in. We're going to change this. We must change this. We will not be able to survive this if we do not change it. When we look at these plans that our government has for us, isn't it just make your head spin? To see the things that Alex Jones has been talking about for a long time. The fact that people used to make fun of him because he would put something over the camera on his monitor. Now it's common knowledge. Everybody knows that everyone from the government to hackers can look at anything in your house with the technology that they have. And even though our government has been caught time and again breaking the law, they get away with it. And at the meantime, they're looking at a battlefield where they have augmented humans, superhumans, with implants in them, controlling autonomous killing machines, operating in swarms with directed energy fields and force fields. This is insane. If we don't stop it, that will be the future that our children have. Stay with us. Joining us at the bottom of the hour is going to be Jakari Jackson. We're going to talk about some updates on some gun control issues, things that are happening throughout the country. We're also going to take a look at the Alamo rally that we had some time ago for open carry. That's coming up at the bottom of the hour. We're going to get back to the news. We're going to take a look at the horse race. It begins tonight. Starting gate is tonight in New Hampshire. They're going to have the very first debate. A few days later, on Thursday, we're going to have the big Fox News debate. So we're going to talk about both of those. Before we do, I just want to let you know that we have extended free shipping for one more week. We know that a lot of people are on vacation. A lot of people did not take advantage of the free shipping we had for the month of July at InfoWarsLife.com. We had it up on the site. We really didn't talk about it much until the last week or so. And so as a thank you to you, we've extended this one more week. All the products at InfoWarsLife.com are available with free shipping. Products like OxyPowder. OxyPowder is the all-natural oxygen colon cleanser that's available at InfoWarsLife.com. It's scientifically formulated to gently cleanse the colon, and it doesn't require time off from work. Whenever you look at our site, you can see product reviews there. It's a good way to make up your mind, to get a feel for what the product is about. Let me read you one of the reviews about Oxy Powder. This is from Frog in British Columbia, Canada. He says, this is the most effective intestinal cleanse I've ever experienced in over 40 years of experimenting. It has no side effects except the obvious cleansing of the stomach and intestines. It is apparently oxygen-based and has to be healthy with zero risk except for the risk of not getting to the bathroom in time, perhaps, he says. Four pills seems to keep working for me the whole week. When using this product, my overall sense of well-being is incredible. Thanks, InfoWars. Well, thank you. Thank you for supporting us. Thank you for supporting this operation. That is what supports our operation, the products that we sell at InfoWarsLife.com. Again, you can get those this week for free shipping. We've extended that as a thank you this week, one more week. During the previous segment, I know a lot of people are getting the news during that segment on a lot of station affiliates. We were talking about Norman Lear. I started to say Norman Mailer. I know Norman Mailer died a few years ago. Norman Lear, of course, the producer of All in the Family, The Jeffersons, many shows that were very popular in the 70s. He was 93, and he talked to a film critic organization in Beverly Hills, and he was talking about how things have changed since he was a kid. He says, when he was a kid, he was in love with America. I'll just paraphrase this. I won't read the whole quote like I did in the last one. He was in love with America. They taught in civics classes and public schools that he was guaranteed freedom because he had a Bill of Rights, because he had a Constitution. He said, because of those words and the Declaration of Independence that protected me. He says, I knew that because we had civics in class. We don't have that much in the country anymore. And that's true. As I was pointing out, we now have essentially in our schools, as we pointed out over and over again, a brave new world. Sexualizing the children, a prison environment. I wonder what Norman Lear would think about if he went to a typical school today. It looks like you're going into a prison. You've got metal detectors. You've got police roaming the halls. In many cases, like we did here in Bastrop, there was a fight between some students. One guy was trying to break it up. There was nothing going on. You can see it from the surveillance camera. And this cop, the security cop, which we didn't have even when I was in school, certainly not when Norman Lear was there. This cop comes up, tasers this kid, and he goes straight down on the concrete floor and has brain damage, permanent brain damage from that. That's the kind of world we live in now. I wanted to read you this article and tell you about an experience I had 25 years ago. This article, I'll just read you the headlines. A teenager sues the police after being jailed for 40 days over a snowball and then cleared of wrongdoing. So they threw a snowball or something. So they put him in jail for 40 days. They don't charge him. That's the America we live in today. Let me tell you, 25 years ago, in the neighborhood where we had a retail store, it was a snow day. Snow didn't happen that often in North Carolina. When it did, they shut everything down. On this particular street, it was a very steep street, and it was filled with snow. Nobody was driving, going anywhere. Everything was stopped. The parents went out on the street with their children, and they were sledding down the street. And some cops came up and told them they had to stop. And the parents said, well, we've got this street blocked off. We're not letting anybody come in here. Nobody's getting out. It's very, very heavy snow. So, no, you can't do that anymore. And they started getting horsey with the people. They're bossing people around, threatening to arrest somebody, just like we see with this story here today. And what happened, and it made the front page of the Cary News, Cary, North Carolina, everybody on that cul-de-sac started throwing snowballs at the police, and they left. They ran them off with snowballs, throwing snowballs at them. Today, that wouldn't happen. What do you think would happen today? I think they'd just start beating, tasering, and shooting people because that's what they've been taught by the federal government. That's the curriculum that they teach in the police academies. That's the rules of engagement that they have for us civilians. You hear the terms, the military terms, rules of engagement, civilians? That's what we see in today's America. We must stop this. We must turn this around. Do you hear any of this happening with the presidential candidates? Do you hear them talking about these issues? I don't think so. Today we have the horse race starting. Listen, this is how it's going to sound tonight.
They're into the stretch. Lady Mutata, my wife knows everything.
My wife
center
knows
of the
everything.
Track, the wife doesn't know. Into the final furlong, my wife knows everything. The wife doesn't
know. Yeah, it's
know.
A horse
They're
race.
One, two. Of course they are.
And I think this horse race between a couple of different know. Horses
my
and this race announcer. I don't know if this is for real or not. But I do know that the one of the horses in this race is not going to make the final cut for the big debate coming up on Thursday. That would be the horse, he's got glasses now. That's Perry. He's in 11th place. Looks like he's not going to make the main cut. He's going to be on the junior varsity team for the Fox debate. That means they're not going to be in prime time. I guess he's not ready to be a prime time player yet in this. And, of course, those rules, they say, are taking center stage. Washington Street, Wall Street Journal says that it's largely because there's 17 contenders. They're only going to allow 10 on Thursday on Fox News. Who will make the primetime cut, they say? Well, they're going to relegate candidates to a second-tier event. I don't know when that's going to be, but it will be on Fox News, I guess. Here's what Rick Santorum said. Finally, I agree with something that Rick Santorum said. He said, national polls mean nothing. Unfortunately, the networks and the Republican National Committee have gone along with this irrelevant measure of legitimacy of candidacy and then have the ability to influence who's in the top 10 by the amount of coverage they get and the amount of advertising dollars. New Jersey Governor Chris Christie also said about Donald Trump, he said that his lead could start to erode if he's forced to provide more details on his policy agenda. He said anybody can do well for a month in this business, especially if you have talent and you have personality, and Donald has both of those things. Isn't that interesting? Anybody can do well in this business, and it is a business for them, folks. It is a phony business. It is a horse race business. It's a casino business. Do you have a stake in this? You know, there's a lot of people who have big stakes in this. We talked yesterday about all the money that Planned Parenthood got from Hillary Clinton's State Department. They made a $3.5 million donation to some of the causes that were important to Hillary Clinton. And just from the State Department, they got $100 million. That's about a 3,200% return on investment. Now, why wouldn't these people play this horse game? They've got a big stake in this. These guys have got big bets riding on these horses. But of course, what do you have riding on them? Are you going to get 3,200% return on your investment like Planned Parenthood? Are you going to get billions of dollars worth of contracts from people that you gave maybe $1 million to run for office? No, you're not going to get that. What are you going to get? Your only stake is your individual liberty. Who is standing up for that? That's what you need to look at. Who are the candidates that are going to shut you down on that? And understand that they've got this game rigged in both ways. The wife knows everything. The wife knows nothing. They're neck and neck, as you just heard in that. Okay? They've got these horses. They own all the horses. They've got their bets covered. No matter which way this thing breaks, they're going to win. The only way you're going to win is if you can find something to do that is going to get you more individual liberty. Bring back the rule of law. Is there anybody talking about that? Make that person the focus of your attention. Try to get that person attention. I don't think that anybody, as I've said many times, I don't think anybody is going to be able to go to Washington and save us. Not Mr. Smith, not a messiah. People who think that everything is over, we've got to back candidate A or candidate B. Donald Trump, if we don't get Donald Trump, everything is over. If you don't support Donald Trump, you support Hillary Clinton. Look, Trump supports Hillary Clinton. Donald Trump gave the Clintons millions of dollars, tens of millions of dollars. Okay? The wife doesn't know anything. The wife knows everything. That's the horse race that we got in front of us. Tonight, there's going to be a debate in New Hampshire. 14 of the 17 Republican candidates for president plan to participate in a candidate forum in New Hampshire tonight. This is going to be on C-SPAN at 7 p.m., from 7 p.m. till 9 p.m. And they say, of course, this is not a debate. Candidates will each have about 5 minutes to answer questions individually. Of course, none of these things are debates. We're not going to have any real debates. There might be some back and forth or people yell at each other, but this is not a debate, as everybody knows. It's not a debate, but it'll begin tonight. And then, of course, we'll have the big debate in prime time on Thursday where Frank Luntz will do his horse race thing. He'll tell you who's ahead, who's winning, who's nudging up on this particular one. Hillary Clinton, she's got a summer slump. She's running as hard as she can. I mean, I'm reading this literally off of the LA Times. She's running as hard as she can. Her numbers are down, but she's trustworthy and honest. She got mixed reviews with her policy speeches. This is the nonsense of the horse race. Stay with us. We'll be right back. We were just talking about the horse race. We're just getting into Hillary Clinton. You know, she's got a big problem. People are looking at her and they don't like her. It's not just her summer slump. She's got massive criminal indictments waiting in the wings. That's a pretty dangerous place for your candidate to be. So we've got Maureen Dowd saying, maybe we ought to run the CEO of Starbucks. They're getting pretty desperate. Joe Biden, they're talking about running Joe Biden. That's how desperate they are. And of course, Joe Biden is channeling his late son, saying that, well, he would have wanted me to run and everything. So he's going for that angle to get into the race. But yeah, Joe Biden, maybe the CEO of Starbucks. I don't know. Let's cast the net pretty wide. So what she got to do? She's got to make herself likable. You know, The Onion, which kind of leans heavily to the left, even ran a thing about Hillary Clinton saying that she was suspended by the FEC for 3 weeks because she spit on her staffers. I mean, that's the arrogance of this lady. Even the left knows that. So she's going to run some television ads, $2 million of television ads, all about her mom. Let's listen to a little bit of this. I don't know if you can get all the way through of it.
Her parents abandoned her when she was just 8 years old. She was mistreated, but she never gave up.
Vintage pictures.
And she taught me to do the same. My mom's life and what she went through are big reasons why standing up for kids and families became such a big part of my life.
She's America's grandmother.
School, she could have gone to a big firm, but instead went to work for the Children's Defense Fund. In Arkansas, she fought for school reform to change lives forever. Then as First Lady, she helped get health care for 8 million kids. You probably know the rest. The senator who made sure the heroes and families of 9/11 got the care they needed.
Okay, that's enough. She's running as America's grandmother. That's how Hillary Clinton wants you to see her. That is a huge stretch by anybody's imagination. So what does she do? She pulls up vintage pictures of her mom. And when they finished with all the vintage pictures of her mom, they showed some pictures of Hillary talking about when she was a young lawyer. I've seen some pictures of Hillary Clinton. I've heard some recordings of Hillary Clinton when she was a young lawyer. I heard her cackling about how she got off a rapist on a technicality. Heavy Southern accent at the time. She was very young. But yeah, that's the kind of cynical Hillary Clinton I know. The kind of Hillary Clinton we're going to make sure you know as well. Democrat debates, well, they seem to have vanished. There were six scheduled, but of course, there seem to be none in the works. Tonight, there will be a Republican debate in New Hampshire. There will be 14 GOP candidates out of the 17 that have announced that they're going to run. Donald Trump will not be a part of that. I think it's a pretty smart idea for him to sit back and watch the other guys go after each other before the big primetime debate on Thursday. Donald Trump is very smart. You got to give him that. And he's also a straight talker, and he expresses the anger that people have, which we don't see that kind of compassion from other people. Take a look at this article from Politico. You've got Carly Fiorina targets Bush, Clinton, and the media at a Koch-funded summit. Yes, there was a summit with the Koch brothers this last Saturday. You had Jeb Bush and four others, Ted Cruz, Marco Rubio, Carly Fiorina, Scott Walker, all went there hat in hand looking for money and approval from the Koch brothers. And this is what Carly Fiorina's take on it. She says, I think Donald Trump taps into the same thing I hear out there all the time. People are tired of sanitized sound bites. They're tired of bumper sticker rhetoric. They're tired of fancy speeches and no results. They're tired of a lot of talk and no action. But I think she misses it. She says, how is she going to do better than Donald Trump in this? She says, well, it's our tone. We have to have a nominee who's both a fighter and empathetic, strong yet evidences humility. We can't be judgmental. We can't be vitriolic. We can't be angry. Baloney. You need to get angry. Anybody that is not angry when they see what's going on with our country is an idiot. That's why none of these people are getting any traction except for Donald Trump. He's the only one that expresses outrage at the outrageous actions of our current government. I don't agree with his solutions, but at least he's got outrage about this. If Carly Fiorina thinks she's going to get somewhere by being empathetic, non-vitriolic, not angry, not judgmental, you're not even going to get out of the gate. This is ridiculous. She did have a good line about Clinton. She said that Clinton doesn't understand technology. She guarded her private email server from hackers by using two Secret Service agents. Yeah, that's funny. But you know what? That isn't really going to get you anywhere. And we're not going to get anywhere if we just stick to sound bites. We need to understand what's going on. Donald Trump opposed TPP, but he opposed it because he thought that Obama couldn't negotiate a good deal. Not because it's a subversion of our country. It's illegal. It's going to destroy our sovereignty. That's why you should oppose it, because we have something called the Constitution. Stay with us. We're going to be right back with a report about the anti-gunners at the Alamo and with Jakari Jackson. Stay tuned.
This is the heart of 1776. It wasn't one of the reasons that the war against King George began. It was the central, main, final reason at Lexington and Concord. Right. And it wasn't one of the reasons there was a rebellion against the dictator Santa Anna, later thrown out in Mexico proper. It was the main, central reason they met at Washington on the Brazos, yeah, where my great-great-great-great-great-grandfather heirs helped kick the whole thing off to say, we're not turning our guns in, and we're not running, and we're not backing down. If you want them, come and take them.
That was just an excerpt from my Alamo speech back on October 20th, 2013 in San Antonio, Texas. They'd said that open carry was illegal, even though state law said we could. They had a phony local law that was trumped. Over 1,500 Americans, black, white, Hispanic, Asian, together, gave the first political speech that's been allowed since the Alamo was rebuilt. It was just a warehouse and turned into a shrine. One of the state officials did the right thing and allowed this to happen. Very, very excited about that. And I was able to give a speech. I got so excited I blew my voice out, something I rarely do. But then we're walking down the street and saw the mainstream media covering a bunch of anti-gunners funded by Bloomberg. So we went over and they freaked out on us. And it's just such a dichotomy how fearful these people are and how they blame gun owners for what's happened to them or people they know. I mean, if somebody runs over you with a Ford truck, you don't blame Ford, you blame the crazy person with the car. If somebody stabs you or beats you to death with a Louisville Slugger, you know, your family doesn't blame the Ginsu knives or Louisville Slugger. That's common sense. So why do we blame the guns? But it's just like some crazy goes and kills nine people in South Carolina. We blame white people on the Confederate flag. It's just politics so absolutely dumbed down to the most mindless level. So I thought on this August 3rd global transmission, it's good to kick a Monday off remembering that everybody else except for Switzerland has been disarmed. And countries that are disarmed always devolve into tyrannies. So, you know what? If you don't like Second Amendment, get out of the country. And stop throwing your guilt trips where you try to guilt us into turning our guns in so we can live in a hellhole like South Chicago, New York, or D.C. Go to those places to be fed on by predators. We don't want to be victims. Do you got it?
We want to interview the moms, the marching, what, Million Mom March, or whatever they are. You know where they are? Down there, maybe?
We have no idea. We
Roger that. We can't even find them. So we're going to go look for them, ask them a few questions about why they like gun control, why they like statistically more deaths, and why they like Mexico. So, but we're trying. We can't even find them anywhere.
Are you the head of the local organization?
No, I'm not.
I'm the head of the local.
Hey, how you doing? I'm Alex Jones.
Hi, how are you doing?
Good, good, good. Yeah. Good. So tell us about what you're doing here today.
Well, I would prefer to have just a moment to talk to you off camera before we, you know, you bring your cameras in to our event. Is that okay?
Well, he's just right there.
It's just
First Amendment. You're a public group. We're just wondering.
I thought this was to raise awareness.
If crime rates have dropped 49% since 1992 because of gun ownership increasing, why would we want to be like Mexico, where they've taken all the guns, they have the highest crime rate in the world, or Chicago?
Okay, I'm not going to stand here and be bullied by you into having a conversation that
you know,
is
Mr.
not.
Jones,
whoa!
Can't wait.
No, whoa! You just. Whoa! She just rammed in to me.
I know I came over to ask you to please.
Wow, you just, that's like assault.
Yeah, is
it? Isn't this a public event?
Why did you touch me?
Because I don't like you.
You don't like me?
No.
Why?
Why didn't you leave her alone? We're having a peaceful time here.
Well, I just don't want anybody to touch me. You already slammed into me. You're not going to touch me, are you, sir?
Go away. We don't want you here. We don't want you.
What's wrong? We were so friendly.
What public event is this? We don't want any exposure.
We thought you wanted press. We're press. We're here to be friends.
Okay, rally go.
It went really well. We're going to have more of them. We're going to take our civil rights back.
You're taking your civil rights.
Just like in 1776.
Who took your civil rights?
They've taken the guns in Chicago, New York, D.C.
They're taking your guns?
Feinstein says the goal is to ban all the guns. It says right here.
Nobody's trying to take your toys.
They haven't taken the guns?
Assault weapons.
Ban assault weapons.
Trying to take
They're
the guns.
Not trying.
Says right here.
Wait.
That's all semiotic.
Shut up and let me talk.
Oh, yes, ma'am.
You are not saying that correctly. We want to ban, she wants to ban assault
Who's
weapons
she?
In the, Diane Feinstein, you're the one that brought her up.
But Bloomberg wants a total ban.
Wait. But they don't want to confiscate
have
from
they
people that already
Did they confiscate guns in New Orleans?
They say there are no orders to use force, just strong persuasion. Sometimes entering open houses with guns drawn. And instructions to disarm anyone inside.
You say guns will be taken.
No one will be able to be armed. We
yes,
will
sir.
Take all weapons.
Yes,
have they banned the guns in Chicago and New York and D.C.?
No, they have not.
Mayor Bloomberg, how you doing? Jason, I grew up in Brooklyn.
Okay,
in the spirit of gun control, will you disarm your entire security team?
No. You will think. Get right back to you.
You'll get back to me?
They have not banned the guns. You do not want our guns. That's well, good.
We want your guns.
Good.
We don't want you here.
Santa Ana wanted the guns.
Reality statistics, you're very upset. We're very sorry that we brought facts and reality.
What about the 49% drop in violent crime since 1992 because of gun ownership going up? I'm a libertarian. Shake my hand. Come on. Want a hug? How about a hug? How about a hug? Come on. Come on. I support. Yeah, here.
We're being nice about this whole thing.
Yeah, how about be friends? Here. What's your name?
Matt. Yeah.
Matt, listen, you know Hitler was for gun control.
It's going to be 1776 again, isn't it?
Well, we're trying to avert. We're trying to avert 1776.
Once you bring up Hitler, you're obviously not serious about the conversation.
No, but Lenin and Stalin and Mao.
Stalin, Hitler. It's just,
Santa Ana, they all came to take the guns. Yeah, governments don't try to take the guns.
Uh-huh.
Well, here's like people that like gun control ban them all in like Chicago, New York, and D.C. So why wouldn't we think that there's really a plan to register them and take them if they've taken them other places? Real question.
Why do you assume I'm for that?
No, but I'm saying the bills they're trying to move forward. The mayor pro tem of Austin said, once we register your guns, we will confiscate them.
That there is no gun ban currently, but because of the work that we're doing here today, we will make your side legitimate shortly. So you hang on to that.
You may be one of the more moderate members, but that's the point. It says ban assault weapons, which is even semi-automatic, and ammunition magazines that hold more than 10 rounds. This is a Bloomberg. You guys don't take money from Bloomberg. No money from Bloomberg.
Your rally that you think was so successful, it's so well accepted in Texas, was not accepted nationwide.
And that'll be used to get guns other places. I know, but here's the deal. We are desensitizing people, just like you guys say. The Attorney General said we've got to brainwash people that guns can't even be seen.
One thing that I think is clear with young people and with adults as well is that we just have to be repetitive about this. It's not enough to simply have a catchy ad on a Monday and then only do it every Monday. We need to do this every day of the week and just really brainwash people into thinking about guns in a vastly different way.
So we're not brainwashing, we're reversing. We're openly saying, look, we have a right to own guns.
I don't want people walking around with assault rifles on their backs, walking into Walmart, Starbucks. We don't need
But
that.
You like cops with guns everywhere.
Yes, I
Can
want
I
the
answer
cops
your question?
To have guns.
Here's the deal,
yes.
We're going to have the guns everywhere, and if you guys try to take them,
I don't
1776.
You know what a gun grab is? It's something that nobody in this country wants.
If I could have gotten 51 votes in the Senate of the United States for an outright ban, picking up every one of them, Mr. and Mrs. America, turn them all in, I would have done it.
A gun grab is something that nobody in this country
wants.
Well,
sir, all I can say is you are really getting in my space, like your wife came over and pushed up against me.
Why don't you back up?
No, I'm not going to back up.
Good.
You're the one got in my space.
You know
look
what?
At this. Look at this guy.
Stop.
All right, go ahead.
Stop.
You, listen, I don't want to beat an old guy up. So don't touch me, all right?
This guy could take you out in a heartbeat.
I bet he could. I'm not violent.
Why do you think it's okay to sell a gun to someone that you don't know that's not been through a background check?
Should we have a background check for bathtubs every time we take a bath?
We should have a background check for guns.
Should we have a background check for knives?
You don't believe in a background check?
No. Have you heard about
We all know it's a registration. We have your documents.
Have you read the bill 1565 that says it's against the law to keep a registration and it's a $15,000
fine? But they've caught them keeping it. They've caught them keeping it.
What do you think about knives? I mean, there's a knife assault.
You're giving them what they want. Don't do it anymore.
Listen, don't listen to the facts. Don't listen to the statistics. Just yell at us and call us names. That is the only thing that works.
Did you know assault rifles are using 2% of crimes?
I know an assault rifle was used to murder my daughter in Aurora. I know that.
Well, I'm sorry that...
Yeah, you're sorry.
I didn't curse your daughter. I mean, that's the big issue, is there's probably five people here against the guns, and they're claiming it's probably true, there's a guy had a lot of sadness in his eyes, that it's his loved one that was lost at Aurora, and that's basically our fault. And the media is preying on these victims of gun control and gun-free zones like movie theaters, schools, and military bases, where the SWAT team was ordered to stand down at the Naval Yard. They are preying on us, and they're preying on people that have had loved ones that are lost, in our pain, to then blame others that have the right to self-defense, when overall in the aggregate, guns are saving more lives than they're losing by 40%+ to one. If you look at just 20 years ago, it was 20+ times a gun was used to stop crime or murder. Now it's 40+ times on average. And so I'm like, here's the average. I'm sorry bad stuff happens. It's like cars. God forbid my daughter die in a car wreck. I'm not going to then go out. If it's a drunk driver that did it, I'm going to blame him. I'm not going to blame Ford or Chevy. These people don't get they've lost. We know who they are. We're the liberals. Thomas Jefferson's a liberal.
Again, that was Alex Jones, and that was the open carry rally that we had. InfoWars was a large part of that. Alex spoke at the Alamo, and you could see the interaction with the people there who wanted more gun control. Look, you're not going to control the guns. You're going to control the people. That's what this is about. None of these background checks have stopped any criminals from getting guns. What they have done is create victim disarmament zones, just as we see even in our military. Alex is talking about the Navy Yard shooter. Of course, we've had the Fort Hood shooter. We've now had just recently the shooter who came after military recruitment stations because our government doesn't even trust its own soldiers with guns. It doesn't trust us either. That's why we need to have this. It's not just to protect ourselves, but it is as a check against government power. Ja'Kari Jackson is joining me now to talk about this. But before we do, real briefly, I want to let you know that we have extended free shipping at InfoWarsLife.com. It was something we had for the month of July. We didn't really push it that much in July until the very end of July. And a lot of people we know are on vacation. So we wanted to, as a thank you to you, extend it for one more week. All the products at InfoWarsLife.com you can get with free shipping. And we have an extra special for Silver Bullet. If you buy two Silver Bullet, you get two for free. That's 50% off. Right now, we normally sell out of Silver Bullet during the winter months. We have it in stock right now. It's our 30 parts per million colloidal silver and a deionized base of pure water, and you can get free shipping this week. Again, that's at InfoWarsLife.com, InfoWarsLife.com. Ja'Kari, you were at that rally when we had that. That was pretty amazing. We were both laughing as we were looking at these videos going back there, but of course, it's taken a whole new direction now, hasn't it?
Oh, yes, it has, and just a little bit of background on the open carry rallies. How the whole thing got started with such momentum was the arrest of Master Sergeant C.J. Grisham, U.S. Yes. Army, now retired. This guy was a veteran. Well, he was active duty at the time. He was walking around kind of backwoods Texas, and he had a rifle on him because there's a lot of wild game out there. There's wild hogs and all this. So he's out there walking around with his son. He encounters a police officer. And the officer's like, why are you walking around with the gun? He's like, I'm trying to protect myself from these wild animals.
And he's got it shouldered.
Yeah, he has it shouldered. He's not carrying in a manner calculated to cause alarm. And the officer basically arrests him. I think the charge was, quote, rudely displaying a firearm.
Yeah.
And then...
And roughed him up pretty
much. Yeah, yeah. And then going to San Antonio, guys get arrested, open carrying, which is completely legal in the state of Texas to open carry your long gun. So they arrest people out there, and people say, we've had enough of this, so we're going to have a big open carry rally at the Alamo. It was the first one ever. I don't think just open carry rally, just like official rally anywhere. Jerry Patterson helped us out with that, and big thanks to him. So, you know, you had about 1,500 people out there, not all of them carrying, but many people came and interacted. And as soon as this thing was over, Dave, you've seen the video, the police come up and tell people you have to leave. Yeah. And he's like, the rally's over. He's like, my Second Amendment's not over. You know, and
they started picking on people. When there's 1,000 people, the cops were taking pictures of us from the
from shooting out of windows and stuff.
Exactly.
Yeah.
But then when it was over and as people started leaving and there was just a few people left, they started it right again, started picking on people like that. You were at the state capitol when they came after and I think they arrested, didn't they? A guy that had a black powder pistol, which is not even considered a firearm.
Right, under Texas state law, a black powder pistol, which is basically a pirate gun. You go watch Pirates of the Caribbean, that's the same kind of guns that these guys had. And he wasn't even on the Capitol grounds. He was in front of the fence, and they arrested him anyway. And I've seen many other people, some of the open carry guys, CJ Grisham, all these other guys, Justin DeLosh, Lone Star Gun Rights, all those guys as well. So it's a big problem. But to anybody who would say the open carry movement has been a black eye to firearms rights, they just recently passed a concealed carry of your pistol and also your open carry of your pistol. Now, it's not constitutional carry, something that they wanted to get, but it's still a step in that direction. So,
that's right.
And these were the guys who were out there. You know, Grisham, CJ, Justin DeLosh, all these guys. They're the guys who've been out here for a long time campaigning for this. And it's actually their actions that I think had a large presence.
We had our rights taken by us incrementally, by incremental infringement. That's exactly what they knew would happen in the Second Amendment. That's why they say that. They say, the right to keep and bear arms will not be infringed. They knew it would be a gradual process, just like somebody taking their fence and moving it onto your property and then leaving it there for a while. It's like, okay, that's mine now. Then moving it a little bit further. And so now we're taking back our property, which our rights are our property as well. Taking it back little by little. Of course, as you pointed out, it's not constitutional carry. I think you still need to have a concealed carry license in order to open carry your
pistol. Yes, you still need to have open carry license to carry it. But also, it was AJ who I kept saying. I meant to say CJ, but I'm saying AJ. But I have an article here, David, I want to point out, and I didn't preview the guys to this, so I'm kind of shooting from the hip here. But we were talking earlier about the First Amendment versus the Second Amendment, and we have an article from the New American we can get to. But I want to address something that the gentleman said in the video. He said it's illegal to have a registry, and there's a big fine and all this stuff. But we've seen people who have registered their firearms be listed pretty much like sex offenders. Mm-hmm. And now we have the article. This is a throwback from back in 2013, the First Amendment versus the Second Amendment, and why a New York paper had every right, they had every right, David, to publish the names and addresses of local gun owners.
Yeah.
So you see, if you do go into the registry, if you go through the paperwork and all this stuff, they can come and publish your name, your address, you know, what type of firearm you have, and tell the thieves or any would-be attackers that you live here. Mm-hmm. So this is what people are concerned about. If you have all your information in this big registry, it can be used against you in a very negative way.
Absolutely. And we know that gun confiscation can easily follow gun registration. That's one of the things that concerns everybody. And you and I were at that rally at the state capitol when we had a local official saying to somebody who was holding up a sign about confiscating guns, he says, don't worry, we're not coming after them, but we're going to make that sign come true. Stay with us. We'll be right back with Jakari Jack. Welcome back to the Alex Jones Show. I'm David Knight, and joining me is Jakari Jackson. Of course, Jakari and I are typically on the nightly news. If you're not a subscriber to Prison Planet TV, if you're not supporting our operation, we'd ask you to please consider doing that. One subscription, and it works out to just pennies a day. If you get an annual subscription, you can share that with 20 people, and they can watch the nightly news every night as it happens, as well as having access to all of Alex Jones's documentaries, all the past broadcasts. And again, that's where Jakari normally is. That's where I normally am. Leanne McAdoo, Darren McBreen, Joe Biggs, all of us, you'll find us there. Rob Dew, we all typically work on the nightly news, and that's one way that you can support our operation. Now, we've been talking about the Second Amendment issues. We played a video from the Alamo Open Carry Rally. We talked about how there's been some movement, some victories in Texas because of that, incrementally taking back our freedoms. Mm-hmm. Let's talk about some of the other issues that have just come up. Of course, you were talking about the shooter in Garland. Where did he get his gun, Jakari?
Well, he got it from Fast and Furious. Lo and behold,
isn't
David.
That interesting?
Now, when they talk about Operation Gun Runner going on with the guns that went to Mexico via courtesy of the ATF, there's a gun shop that's mentioned in this article, which it is correct to say that he did purchase it as a straw purchase, but the gun shop was encouraged to do so by the ATF. Mm-hmm. So, you know, they go and they say, it'd really be swell if you guys give them. He's like, well, I don't really know about that, but they wanted this to happen so they could track these guns to the Sinaloa gun cartel or drug cartel. But as we all know, even if they do track these guns, how many innocent people are going to be killed in the meantime?
Yes.
And of course, nobody gets in trouble. I think it was Lanny Brewer, the assistant attorney general, is the only person who actually got in trouble, even though the official attorney general, Eric Holder, knew about it. He was getting frequent emails, and it's just very difficult for me to believe that at no point in time did he actually know this was going on.
Of course he didn't. Of course he didn't, Shikari. They don't know of any wrongdoing. And even when they find out about wrongdoing, they don't prosecute it as well. And of course, this whole thing blew up in their face because we had a federal agent get killed. Nobody cared about all the Mexicans that got killed. Yeah, because of the putting the guns in the hands of the Sinaloa cartel, the same guy, El Chapo, that we've had so much discussion about because he bought his way out of prison. But of course, Shikari, I believe that that Fast and Furious, the New York Times even reported that it was a false flag attack to take away our gun rights. I believe that was done in support of the UN Arms Trade Treaty, because the key part of that UN Arms Trade Treaty was that it was going to prohibit arm transfers across borders. So what do they do to prime the pump for this legislation? But they set up a pat thing to get people all upset about arms crossing across the borders.
That's right.
And then the solution that they have for that is to register and track everything in this country. And it gets the UN in charge of gun ownership, just like the UN set up the agenda for drug prohibition.
And even after Fast and Furious, you can go back and see those clips on YouTube of the president, I think he was speaking in Mexico, saying that the reason for the Mexican drug or gun violence is because they had so many guns coming from the United States, completely omitting the fact that they got them from the United States government.
Mm-hmm. Absolutely. And so they did this thing. It blew up in their face. And I'm also convinced, because we've looked at a lot of the suspicious aspects of this shooter, the Batman shooter in Aurora, mm-hmm. California. That happened exactly 1 week to the day before they were going to have their vote. And I think that that was a false flag attack on top of the other false flag attack to get this UN arms trade treaty through. I'm absolutely convinced of that. They still didn't get any traction with that because people started arming themselves rather mm-hmm. than running around like chickens with their head cut off about the fact that somebody had a gun. They said, well, you know, it was a gun-free zone. We don't want to be caught without something to defend ourselves.
And as we talk about this, David, you touched on it the other day as well. They're now going to charge the person at the recruitment office for having a pistol on them, a ways to defend themselves. So you go out there, you fight for your country, you fight for your rights, and you come back, you can't even defend yourself.
Absolutely outrageous. We're going to talk about that more, as well as some other articles with Jakari Jackson. Stay with us. We'll be right back. Welcome back to the Alex Jones Show. I'm David Knight, and joining me in studio is Jakari Jackson. We've been talking about gun issues. We mentioned just briefly before the break how Fast and Furious, one of the guns used in the Fast and Furious false flag operation, wound up in the hands of one of the shooters in Garland, Texas. Yeah, Garland, Texas. And Jakari, you mentioned just before we went to the break how one of the officers at one of these recruitment stations, a Navy commander who shot back, is now looks like, according to Alan West, we had that report yesterday, we mentioned it briefly on the news, looks like they're going to charge him for discharging a firearm on federal property. This is amazing.
How dare you defend yourself?
Absolutely. As Alan West said, he ought to get a medal for defending himself and his other officers there. Instead, what he's going to get is a charge.
And to anybody who would demonize the open carry movement, I know it's been very strong here in Texas over the past few years. After we had these very unfortunate shootings at the recruitment stations, who was it that went out and guarded these facilities? It wasn't freaking Bloomberg.
That's right.
It wasn't the moms. It was open carriers and veterans, guys like Joe Biggs, who went out there and defended these stations from any potential attack.
And then it was the government, the Pentagon, who said, if you don't leave, we're going to have you arrested.
Mm-hmm.
I mean, it just makes your head spin to see this. They don't trust us. They don't believe that we should be able to defend ourselves. They don't believe that we should be able to defend our soldiers, okay? That, I think, is a key thing, Jakari. I think they didn't want to see the military being defended by the militia.
Civilians. Yeah, you can't have that. You can't have that. But, you know, they were all appreciative. You know, we were out there. I was out there with Joe Biggs for 2 days. And, you know, people would come by. You know, I guess a lot of them were under orders or whatever not to speak to us. But their wives would come out and talk to us. And said, we really appreciate what you guys are doing. Do you guys need water? Can we buy you guys lunch? You know, one lady showed up with a box of donuts. That's probably about as fast as I've ever seen Joe Biggs move. He jumped up and grabbed those donuts pretty quick. But, you know, it was a good time, you know, it felt good just to go out there and try to help somebody.
Yeah.
You know, just the basic of let's go out here and protect our fellow man. It was just a good, fulfilling experience.
It's a deterrent.
okay, is not a threat. It's a deterrent. If they see people who are armed, then it is a deterrent. It's a deterrent for individual criminals, and it's a deterrent for tyrannical governments to have firearms. There's an article that's up on New American. Celebrating the Second Amendment victory may be premature. Now, what they're talking about in that is a particular law in the state of Florida that provides that any licensed practitioner or facility may not record firearm ownership information in a patient's medical record.
Good.
Unless that information is relevant to the patient's medical care, safety, or the safety of others, because you've got this movement in the medical community to try to talk people out of having firearms, to make it a mental health issue, to make it a health issue in general, to record this, to maybe become some kind of a Stasi snitch.
And we even hear stories about children. You know, they talk to their schools, they go out to these medical facilities. Do your parents own any guns? I'm like, what does this have to do with anything? Mm-hmm, mm-hmm. You know, it's just very bizarre behavior, but it's once again to track, regardless of what they're saying, they want you in a database if you have a firearm. Just like, right. So why is it okay to sell somebody a pistol without doing them a background check? You know, people, a 16-year-old who goes out and gets their license probably doesn't have any DUIs on their record, but 10, 15 years later, that could change. Mm-hmm. You know, so even though they're fine at the time, you know, so it just goes on to show that a background check is not the end all as far as deterrence. And we've seen so many of these shooters who had a background check and still got their firearms anyway.
Well, people should be concerned about this, because we've seen just recently that they're talking about redefining people's mental incompetency to say that if you're a Social Security recipient, not just coming after that's the right. veterans, they've used this in many ways at the VA especially. That's where this is really targeted. Mm-hmm. This is where they really do it. But even if you're a Social Security recipient, they say, well, if you have somebody's help in terms of doing your finances or something, just vague things like that, they could use that to say, well, that means that you're financially incompetent. That means that
you're mentally incompetent.
That means that we can now take your firearms. People need to watch out in all the ways that they're coming after us. Stay with us. We'll be right back with more news. Thank you for joining us, Jakari Jackson.
Thank you, Dave.
We're going to go back to the news, and we're going to go to your calls in the next segment. I have a little bit more news I want to cover before we go to calls. I just wanted to let you know that we have a Monday flash sale. What is a flash sale? Well, it's 30% off Prostaguard for 24 hours. That's what we mean by a flash sale. We're going to drop the price for 24 hours. That's at InfoWarsStore.com. We have Prostaguard, which contains a high selected blend of saw palmetto, lycopene, plant sterols, zinc, vitamin D3, selenium, and copper. This is something I take every day. As we understand, as we get older, just like you have good and bad forms of cholesterol, you have good and bad forms of testosterone. As you get older, the bad form, dihydrotestosterone, becomes more prevalent. It's been associated with things like prostate enlargement, male pattern baldness. A lot of studies have shown that saw palmetto is a good way to control that. Well, Prostaguard has not only saw palmetto, it also has lycopene and these other ingredients that I just mentioned. You can get it right now for the next 24 hours, 30% off at InfoWarsStore.com. That's InfoWarsStore.com. Free shipping on everything there this week. We've extended it for people. We had a lot of response in this last week with people taking us up on the free shipping, I think. And so as a thank you to you, and as also recognition that a lot of people may not have known about that because they're on vacation, we've extended that for one more week. Now, as I talked earlier about the horse race, as I said, you know, I think we need to understand what's going on globally. We need to understand what's going on nationally. We need to look at the agenda. We need to see how we're being played. We need to not fall into some kind of a cult of personality with any of these people. Certainly not at this point. We haven't even had the first debate. I'm amazed at the number of people that think it's over. They've already set themselves up, tied themselves to one person, and if that person doesn't get elected, is over. Well, if that's what you think, you're not part of the solution, you're part of the problem. We need to work locally. We need to not get caught up in this identity politics. We saw that happen with Obama, didn't we? Weren't all these conservatives that are now talking about that were talking at that time about Obama concerned about maybe his birth certificate, but also a lot of people were concerned not just about the birth certificate and the secrecy of Obama. That told us something, didn't it? We should have paid attention to the fact that he was shutting down everything in his background, because at the very least, even if you believe that he didn't have anything bad in his background that he was hiding, at the very least, it showed a contempt for transparency At the same time, he was telling us that he was going to be transparent. And what have we seen from the Obama administration? We've seen nothing but an amazing contempt for transparency. We've seen someone who has charged 67% of the people who have been charged under the espionage law of 1917 have been charged under the Obama administration, journalists and others, not just whistleblowers. People who are legitimate sources of information have been charged under this law, and we've had two times the number of people charged under this under Obama than all of the administrations from 1917 up until Obama. He hates transparency. So we should be very concerned about that. We should look at these people. We should vet them. But at the same time, we understand that Mitt Romney was going to give us RomneyCare if we didn't get Obamacare, and that the two of them were exactly the same. We saw RomneyCare in Massachusetts. We saw him do that with Ted Kennedy. We knew that it was exactly the same mechanism. They were going to hold a gun to your head, and they were going to make you buy insurance that you would not normally want to buy, at the level you didn't want to buy, at the price you didn't want to buy. They were going to say it was going to get the cost down, but it was simply crony capitalism forcing you to buy these products. That's what the TPP is about as well. And of course, they're rushing that through. This is the model for crony capitalism. But understand the identity politics. Understand the fact that Obama ran as a brand. Remember when everybody was marching in lockstep and we were all kind of, this is pretty scary. It's pretty scary. This guy's got a logo. And yet I'm pretty scared to see that the Republicans are doing the same thing already. They're not concerned about vetting these people. We've got three candidates now who have questionable backgrounds. You want to talk about what a natural-born citizenship is? We can have that discussion, but the people who were talking about that with Obama, we've got three candidates who are questionable. If you want to question that for Obama, we've got three GOP candidates, not just one this time. We got Cruz, we got Rubio, we got Jindal. I don't believe any of them meet the legal definition of natural-born citizen. So the GOP is playing identity politics as well. On the Democrat side, they want to have somebody who is black or somebody who's a woman because they're all about trying to avoid any appearance of racism or sexism or white privilege. On the Republican side, everybody wants to get rich. It's all about money. That's the freedom that they really can get excited about, is the freedom to have property, to own money. Actually, I should take back the freedom to have property, because they're willing to throw that under the bus in order to have a war on drugs, because we have lost our fundamental property rights, our fundamental rights to due process, with civil asset forfeiture, which they continue to support, most of them. I mean, Rand Paul doesn't. I don't know if any of the other candidates have taken a stand on that. But that's where we are today. So what can we do if we can't trust a savior to carry us on a feather bed from a state of tyranny to a state of liberty? That's what Thomas Jefferson warned us about. He said, they're not going to do it for you, folks. They're not going to put you on a soft, cushy bed and carry you from tyranny to freedom. And it doesn't matter. You're not going to find somebody. Even if we elected Thomas Jefferson, he couldn't single-handedly stand down this massive perpetual bureaucracy that we have in Washington, this disregard for the rule of law. So what do we do? Well, there are some things that we can still do. We can still, it's good to send people who are going to stand up and do the right thing. We have a few people like that in Washington. We need to send more of them. And I'm not saying that we just completely drop out of the political process, but understand it's far more easy to do something at the state level and at the local level than it is to do something in Washington. I think the only thing at this point we can do with Washington is primarily to cut it off. And the way we do that is with state nullification. We do that with jury nullification. Jury nullification, if you understand your rights, that is a very important check on government's power. I was just talking to Jakari Jackson about the Second Amendment. That was set up as a check on government power. It was set up as a way to defend yourself, and it was also set up as a check on government power. Jury nullification is a little bit different, because jury nullification, you can't really protect yourself. You have to rely on your neighbors to understand what is going on. So let me read you a story, because a lot of times we just talk to people about principles and policies. They don't really get it. Let me give you a personal story about how somebody's life was affected by this. This article is not guilty. This is from Free Thought Project. Not guilty. Logic prevails after the state charged a man with murder for facilitating a pot sale. This is in Wichita, Kansas. A bright light now brilliantly shines where there was once only darkness. An innocent man who is being railroaded because of the state's immoral drug law has beaten the system, and the justice has prevailed. Kyler Carricker's world turned into a nightmare April 17th, 2013, when he and a friend had finished work and they were headed to go out fishing. The pair was stopped by a train where they ran into Carricker's former classmate, and Carricker was asked if he could find any smoke, meaning marijuana. Carricker said he could try, so they exchanged phone numbers. What Carricker didn't know was that his old classmate from school had since become an active gang member. This former classmate tried to rob Carricker and whoever else was involved in the marijuana transaction. So Carricker agreed to meet his former classmate at his friend Kyle Belt's home to introduce his former classmate and the marijuana dealer. However, the former classmate arrived with several other gang members, later testified in court to the fact that the plan was to rob these two guys. Instead, what they did was they came in and shot them. Now, Carricker himself got shot, although one of the other guys that was at the place died from the injuries. So now this is what the state of Texas does. Understand, let's just recap this. This guy sees a former classmate. He says, well, can we arrange a deal where I can just get some marijuana? They set this thing up. One of the guys comes in and shoots everybody there and just to rob them. That's one aspect of the war on drugs. We've created hardened criminals, gangs that are far worse than anything we had under alcohol prohibition. Remember, it was under alcohol prohibition that we had people riding the running boards of Model Ts, spraying the town with Tommy guns, and now we have these kind of gangs. It wouldn't have even happened if we didn't have prohibition. But nevertheless, this guy who gets shot, the other guy gets killed, they come after the guy who was shot and say, well, you were arranging a marijuana deal, and so because somebody got killed as part of that, we are going to hold you responsible for murder. They say the state of Kansas added marijuana offenses to a list of inherently dangerous felonies or crimes where death is likely to occur. The law was amended on July 1st, 2013, 3 months after this incident, but they retroactively applied it to this case. So there you go. They retroactively applied this law to something that had happened 3 months earlier. Problem number one. Problem number two was the law. And so what happened was when the jury took a look at this, they basically said, the law is wrong. We're not going to hold this guy responsible for this murder. We're not going to treat it as if he killed this person because he arranged a drug deal and the drug dealer had set this up to kill everybody. We're not going to do it that way. So basically, they looked at the law and they shut the law down in this particular case. That is jury nullification. Now, unfortunately, what they did not do is they did not let him go because it was just marijuana. This guy is still looking at a jail sentence for possession and sale of marijuana. We have to watch each other's backs. We have to understand and get the word out because the judges will lie to you. They will take punitive actions against any lawyers who say this. So this is something that we have to tell each other, that you are the judge not only of the facts of the case, you are the judges of the law. The judge is just there as a referee. That's not what they will tell you. Stay with us. I've got a few more articles I want to cover, some news that has come out today. And then we're going to go to your calls. If you want to call in, that number is 800-259-9231. Again, that number is 800-259-9231. We'll kind of leave that open. I would like to talk about some of the news that we've talked about today, but of course, we'll kind of leave that open to pretty much any kind of subject that you want to talk about. Here's one thing that we talked about at the very top of the show. Many people have a news break at that point in time, might not have heard this. There is now a movement to, of course, recall Boehner. Mark Meadows, if you remember last week, put out a measure last week on the floor. I don't know, it wasn't a bill. I'm looking to see exactly what they call it. Let's just call it a measure, saying that Boehner should vacate the speakership. Now, Mark Meadows is one of a group of people who has been punished by Boehner in the past because they didn't follow exactly with procedural votes how he wanted to run things, and so he took them off of subcommittees, which is a way of just making you totally powerless and irrelevant. That's using that as a weapon. Of course, the GOP voters are very angry at Boehner as well because of the cynical way that he has conducted himself after the election, just ignoring the issues that the GOP ran on in terms of changing Obamacare, in terms of changing the open borders. Now, the interesting thing about this is that Boehner was going to bring this up and get rid of it for the summer. He was going to bring it up right away and just dismiss it, saying, "Ah, there's no support for this." However, they took the precaution of starting to contact some of the members in Congress, and they found out that maybe we don't have the votes to reelect John Boehner as Speaker of the House. Now, that's encouraging news. I find that very encouraging. This is what they say. I know members personally who were called by Steve Scalise, so they had the entire leadership whip team frantically making phone calls to members to whip the vote because they wanted to attempt to embarrass Meadows and call the vote on Wednesday of last week so that it wouldn't be hanging over Boehner's head. What they found out was the exact opposite. They found out bad things would happen. Yeah, like maybe not winning that vote. That literally they would be calling the vote without knowing what would happen in terms of what they might not vote to retain Boehner as Speaker. Therefore, they did not call the vote. Now they have this issue hanging over John Boehner's head for the next 5 weeks because they've gone home for summer recess. Call your Republican congressman and tell them that you want them to vote against John Boehner as Speaker. We have an opportunity to get this guy out of office. Take it. Push it. There's already a lot of weakness. They were going to do this right away, right after he introduced it. The next day, they were going to do it. And then they found out, we might lose this vote. This is an opportunity for us to get him out of the speakership. So if you have a Republican, this is something we can all get behind. If you're a Democrat, you can get behind this. If you're a Republican, you can get behind it. If you're an independent, you can get behind it. Let's get John Boehner behind us. Let's get him out of the speaker position. This is something we all ought to be able to support. Here's another story. We were talking about how the VA was coming after veterans, how they were trying to take their gun rights as well. Well, we also know there's been a massive scandal about waiting times, telling people, yeah, we're going to set you up, we're going to give you health care, and then never putting them on the list. Now, some people have been charged. One VA hospital executive has been charged with 50 counts of lying to investigators in this alleged role as a record-changing scheme. They say it was his responsibility to ensure that more than 2,700 veterans awaiting approval for care outside of the system were properly referred to for doctor's appointments. This is the Washington Post reporting that, and this article is coming from the American Mirror. They say that he was on leave without pay pending the outcome of the court process, and he's accused of ordering his staff to falsify medical records of veterans who are waiting for outside medical care. Then the plot thickens. Prosecutors say that they are now adding to those charges after they allege that Henderson contacted a potential witness for the prosecution's case, according to the Augusta Chronicle, and engaged in possible witness tampering. So this is a VA case that is the Norwood VA Medical Center in Augusta, Georgia. So now he's got additional charges of witness tampering. And as I mentioned at the top of the hour, we finally have seen one person out of this massive LIBOR rigging, out of all the money laundering that we had from HSBC and everything, one person now has been found guilty of a criminal conviction. Remember, of course, Eric Holder and his lieutenants said that they would not take any actions against HSBC in terms of their charter. They gave them a very small, relatively small fine. We look at it, we look at fines that are $1 billion or more, and we say, wow, that looks like a lot of money. Not when you look at how much money they made off of this. And of course, HSBC had a special window for money laundering for the Sinaloa cartel, the same people that made El Chapo a billionaire, bought his way out of prison. But now, finally, one individual, a lower-level person, has gone to jail, 8 counts of conspiracy as part of the LIBOR rigging scandal. But, of course, the big guys will go free. Stay with us. We'll be right back. We'll take some of your calls, 800-259-9231. We're going to go to your calls in just one moment. Before we do, I want to let you know that we have a flash sale, a 24-hour sale with 30% off Prostagard. That's at theinfowarsstore.com. Prostagard contains a blend of saw palmetto, lycopene, plant sterols, zinc, vitamin D3, selenium, and copper. Something I take every day. From my research, I understand that as men get older, we need to have something that is going to help to combat the increase in bad testosterone, dihydrotestosterone, as I mentioned before, things associated with prostate enlargement, male pattern baldness. These are why we see these kinds of changes in our bodies as we get older as men. Saw palmetto, there's been a lot of studies that show that that's associated with helping to control that level of that hormone. Also, Prostagard has not only saw palmetto, but lycopene, which, as we pointed out before, is more effective in combination with these ingredients. Again, you can get that for 24 hours, 30% off Prostagard, as well as free shipping. We've extended that for 1 week. We had it for the month of July. A lot of people are on vacation. A lot of people, I think, didn't know about it. So just in case, and as a thank you to those who support our operation, we've extended free shipping for everything at InfoWarsLife.com. And InfoWars Store, we've extended that now for another week. So you can get free shipping on the health products that we sell. Let's go to your calls. We've got Eric in Germany. Eric, you said you wanted to talk about the economic collapse. Go ahead.
Hey, David, thanks so much for taking my call. I hope my connection isn't too bad. I'm talking with you over Skype. I think the whole GOP nomination process is a big dog and pony show because there's no possible way that our economy can make it till November of next year without a correction. The American business cycle is 394 weeks long, and we're at week 402 right now, which means we need a correction, and we need it now. This is just looking off the past 50, 60 years of history. I say this, and I want to call in InfoWars today because you guys need to have a plan, not just you, David, not just the InfoWars staff, not just Alex, but everyone listening to me. The next correction will be uncontainable. We should have had it in 2007, 2008, but Janet Yellen, Ben Bernanke, and Mario Draghi here in Europe has printed money without end, and that's how they've kind of papered over the problem. They haven't actually solved the problem. So what's going to happen in the next correction is it's going to be the correction that should have happened in 2007, 2008, just much larger. I would like to say to you and to your listening audience, this might go a little bit to the people that are a little bit better off. It's important to have a international bug out plan, because when the United States does financially collapse, it will happen. There's an interesting JP Morgan Chase chart from 2012 showing world financial reserve currency status. It usually lasts about 80 to 90 years. We are up on that.
Well, of course, we had a lot of people talking about, we've had a lot of economists talking about how they see something happening this September. You're not the first person to say this. We've had a lot of people warning us about this, warning us that this is going to be a huge factor. You're talking about long-term cycles. What do you think of the work of Strauss and Howe, talking about the generational cycles that we see like every 80 years, talking about the fourth turning that is actually a few years overdue at this point? Have you ever seen that book?
No, I've read part of it. I haven't read it all. Regrettably, I haven't read the whole thing. I do work in finance here in Frankfurt. What I can say is that it is a generational thing. Typically, it's every three generations. For those of you who have kids out there, I'm fairly young, as you can probably tell by my voice. I'm 28. Children want to rebel against their parents, and they always want to do things a bit differently. And what ends up happening is you have grandparents, and then you have the children of these grandparents, and their children do things differently. And then the children of their children, so the grandchildren of the grandparents, want to do things differently from their parents. But what ends up happening is what the children do and what the grandparents do are actually fairly similar to one another. The millennials, even though we get a bad rap and we're lazy and we're entitled, we're actually a pretty hardworking group of people that have just been dealt a bad hand. And it's not necessarily that we're stuck in the middle. It's just that things cannot keep going on as they are. We're stuck in a fiat debt system, and the only way it can keep going on is if the debt keeps expanding. And I say all this to say, once the economic collapse does happen in the United States, it's a when, the American people will be faced with a democratic decision. Do they want to choose freedom, or do they want to choose socialism? And given the current political landscape in the United States, and including two-thirds of the GOP field, I really get the feeling that the American people, for the most part, are going to choose a big government socialism type of answer. The problem is socialism is nothing but death. It brings death and destruction to every culture it's ever touched ever. And so what I encourage all of the listeners of InfoWars right now to do is seriously think, if the United States does become not a complete socialist country, but a very, very social democracy, quote unquote, or actually a social oligarchy, what do you do? And at the end of the day, you have three decisions. You can stand up and fight. You can wait a little bit, Eventually, the system will make you very poor, then fight, or you can leave. I've opted for the third part. Obviously, I'm an American calling you guys from Germany. I've decided to leave. And so this is something that you all need to take into consideration. I know a lot of people are shaking their heads in their car right now saying, man, I can never leave. America is my home. But there's no fighting socialism. Socialism is, I mean, look what it did to the former.
We've seen how that plays out in Venezuela, for example. We saw how it played out in Greece. I mean, certainly we saw where the socialists betrayed the people. They talk about socialism. That's the ideal. That's what they use to get the people to sign up for it. The people think that, well, we're going to have everything paid for. But then what they do is they enact a kind of crony capitalism on top of that. They make way for the banks to come in like they did in Greece. Or in Venezuela, we had the Bloomberg article where they're talking about how they got 700% return on investment, how Hugo Chavez and his successor realized that they needed to pay the banks before their people had food, medicine, and water. So they always use these socialist masks to enact a kind of fascist crony capitalism as well. So we get these different mixtures of it. That's what makes it so confusing for people to pin it down. It's like, well, is it socialism or is it fascism? It's elements of both, isn't it, Eric?
Well, absolutely. Well, I mean, the thing is, you cannot have socialism without authoritarianism. It cannot be done. And the reason is socialism requires a whole culture, not just one or two people, but everyone involved in the system. It requires you to give up your human nature. You see, humans, we're intrinsically greedy, and greedy isn't necessarily a bad thing. It's that the average person listening to this show, if you were faced with a decision, feed me and my family or feed you and your family, every day of the week and twice on Sundays, you'll choose to feed your family over a complete stranger. And what socialism requires is it requires the individual give up what's best for them and theirs for the benefit of the community. And it goes against human nature. It's why socialism doesn't work without authoritarianism. And if you really step back and think about it, when socialism comes into being, and I'm engaged to a former East German girl, when socialism comes into being, the government has to become authoritarian to force people to work. Because if you can sit at home all day long and do nothing but watch TV, work out, sleep late, and drink beer, then and you get paid the exact same as a brain surgeon, why would you do anything?
Absolutely.
So the government has to step in, put a gun to your head, tell you, work. And if they don't, if they were to take the opposite approach of, well, if you don't work, you starve to death, it kind of defeats socialism's purpose to begin with. And so when I say that socialism is coming to the United States, look at Bernie Sanders. He is the Rand/Ron Paul of the left. If you look at what he stands for, it is nothing but it's nothing but Syriza Podemos socialism here in Europe. It's the super left-wing party in Greece. It is the most destructive economic policy that one could possibly imagine, where the government just gives stuff to everyone for free, but it can't be done because we're already borrowing $800 billion a year.
Yeah, absolutely.
There's no.
Thank you, Eric. I want to play. Guys, get up that article while he's talking about socialism. Thank you so much, Eric. I want to get some other people's take on this, but I do want to follow on with what you just said about Bernie Sanders and also about socialism, because we've had Debbie Wasserman Schultz asked pointedly, what is the difference between socialists and Democrats? And we're going to play that clip for you. But before we do, remember that Bernie Sanders supports a $15 an hour minimum wage. Sounds fine in theory. Is that really going to help us? I mean, we saw inflation in Zimbabwe. We've been talking about that as we've talked about Cecil the red herring distracting us from other more important things. We talked about how they went into hyperinflation, went into 11,000,000% inflation. In other words, you got something for $100 and you got 11,000,000% inflation. Well, in a year, it's going to cost you $11 million, not $100. Okay. So, we've been talking about that, but of course, Bernie Sanders, who pushes a $15 an hour minimum wage, what does he pay his staffers? $12 an hour. The ones at the bottom, his interns, are paid $12 an hour. Listen to this story from Seattle. Seattle's $15 minimum wage law just came back to bite them in a totally unexpected way. Just what Eric in Germany was talking about. He said, one unintended effect is that workers who are earning the higher wage are asking for fewer hours so they can remain eligible for low-income government benefits. See, that's the reality of this, as well as the fact that just arbitrarily trying to make people rich by raising the minimum wage doesn't do anything except perhaps feed inflation. Listen to this. They say, despite a booming economy throughout Western Washington, The state's welfare caseload has dropped very little since the higher wage phase began in April. They say in March, 130,851 people were enrolled in the basic food program. In April, that dropped to 130,376. In other words, less than 500 people. In other words, less than 0.36% of the people got taken off of that food program. Why? Because they said, well, we want you to cut back our hours because we don't want to make money. We want to get this free wage. Let's go to what Debbie Wasserman Schultz said about the difference between the Democrats and the socialists. Here's that clip.
What is the difference between a Democrat and a socialist? I used to think there was a big difference. What do you think it is?
The difference between
a Democrat like Hillary Clinton and a socialist like Bernie Sanders.
What's the difference between being a Democrat and being a Republican?
Well, what's the bigger difference? What's the big difference between a Democrat and a socialist? You're chairman of the Democratic Party. Tell me the difference between you and a socialist.
The relevant debate that we'll be having over the course of this campaign is what's the difference between a Democrat and a Republican?
Given that Bernie Sanders is an unabashed socialist, believes in social democratic governments, likes the ones in Europe, what is the difference? Can you explain the difference?
You know, Chuck, it's always fun to be interviewed by Chris Matthews, and I know that he enjoys that banter. The important distinction that I think we're going to be discussing, I'm confident we'll be discussing in this campaign, is the difference between Democrats and Republicans. The difference between Democrats and Republicans is that Democrats want to make sure that people have an opportunity to reach climb the ladders of success and reach the middle class, have a good education, have a secure retirement.
This is the second time she's been asked this clip. They even play the clip from Chris Matthews to start with it and say, hey, here's this clip, you avoided this, so answer me the question, what's the difference between socialists and Democrats? And again, she won't answer that question because it's a distinction without a difference. Bernie has voted down the line with the Democrats and he calls himself a socialist. He's perfectly comfortable with it. You need to understand that there really isn't that much difference between socialism, for example, and crony capitalism, the kind of fascism that we see. Take a look at this. Now, this is not being done for the benefit of one particular corporation, necessarily. The BLM, as we talked about, the Bundy Ranch, taking land in many different areas, shutting down farmers, shutting down miners all over this country. Now we have a Texas farmer who has now won a 30-year battle with the BLM. He's getting his land back. And again, after the situation at the Bundy Ranch that was going on out there, and of course, that is not immediate crony capitalism, but that is a situation like we see in Arizona with John McCain. That is a senator who is turning over vast amounts of public land, in many cases taking private land as well, turning that over to multinational corporations so that they can then destroy it. That's what's going on in Arizona. In this particular case, it was a BLM trying to take land in Texas. They say the victory puts the land back into the undisputed possession of this farmer. It has been in his family since 1904. There's 90,000 acres of land that people still stand to lose to the BLM. This is one of the things that is a key issue with me. When I look at the Keystone Pipeline, something that the Republicans have tried to pass over 10 times, it was the very first thing that they did when they came back from the election, the very first thing they did once the new Senate got sworn in. They have pushed and pushed and pushed for their corporate masters. Now, that's the thing that bothers me. Apart from all of the energy issues, apart from the environmental issues, what bothers me about the Keystone Pipeline is that the Republicans and the people who support this, again, it's Hillary Clinton State Department. Also, it's not just the Republicans. Hillary Clinton State Department was pushing for the Keystone Pipeline as well. What it would do is turn over the right of eminent domain to a foreign corporation, to TransCanada. They would go in, and just like this man had to fight the BLM for 30 years to keep land that was in his family since 1904, and he's finally won, the eminent domain that they're giving TransCanada, they would go in and condemn farms that have been in people's families for over 100 years. That's wrong. It's wrong for one private use to come in and kick somebody else out just because they're smaller. That is bully capitalism. And that's why I cannot support Donald Trump. I've talked about his efforts to run people out of business. We had the Supreme Court decision, Kello versus New London. He said he agreed with it 100%. I disagree with that 100%. You cannot take private property for private use. That's not what eminent domain in the Constitution is about. That's what he tried to do, both in Atlantic City and in Connecticut with a couple of projects. Again, an old lady who's got a house, he offers her $1 million. Is that a good price for that house? I don't know if it is or not. I mean, it was an old house, but it was prime real estate. $1 million, that might not have been enough, nearly enough. Maybe that's why she didn't want to sell it. Maybe she didn't want to sell it for sentimental reasons, like the guy in Up. Nevertheless, it was her property. He had no right to take it. Instead, what he did was he cut the price by down to 25% and got the New Jersey casino thugs, a government organization, to try to take that property from her. I don't like crony capitalism. I like bully capitalism even less. We need to stop it when it's being done by senators. We need to stop it when it's being done by potential presidential candidates. I don't want to see somebody like that in power. Let's go to some more of your calls. Let's go to John in Mississippi. John, you want to talk about climate change?
Yeah, nice to talk to you, Dave.
Nice to talk to you. Thank you.
What I was wondering is a simple question. You know, CO2 is what they tend to say that our trees and that's what our trees breathe in, or what they intake. But yet, the president comes on TV and says, we need to cut back these coal plants. We need to cut back anything that has to do with CO2. Right. Wouldn't that make him kind of like a tree killer? You know, I mean, I'm not much of an environmentalist, but I mean, if you really broke it down, wouldn't that be, you know, kind of.
That's a good point, John. I believe that God created the earth. I believe that he created a complementary system. As you point out, the plants breathe in carbon dioxide. If we have more carbon dioxide, they will breed more easily. And of course, the thing that is really driving any kind of climate change, if it is real, is going to be the sun, not man-made, but done by the sun. Thank you. Well, stay with us. We'll be right back with more of your call. We may go into overdrive because we've got a lot of people that are queued up on the line here. We've got Jim, Kevin, Wild, David. Going to try to go down the list as quickly as we can. Just real quickly before we get back to the phone calls, we do have a flash sale today. That's a 24-hour special. 30% off Prostagard. You can get that at InfoWarsLife.com. You can get free shipping on everything at InfoWarsLife.com. They've extended that for one more week. Our free shipping for the month of July has been extended one more week. And again, you can get 30% off Prostagard for the next 24 hours in that flash sale. Let's go back to our calls. Let's go to Jim in Utah. Jim, you had a comment about Social Security, gun rights. Go ahead.
Yes, I'm one of these people on this Social Security, and I have. They tell me that they're going to say I'm incompetent because I have my check sent directly to the bank. And yeah. The interesting about that is I put that in that way because I wanted to keep the people from stealing it out of my mailbox.
Yeah,
and
a lot of people do that. I mean, most people who are employees. I think pretty much everybody here at InfoWars has their paycheck go direct deposit into the bank because you don't want to have the hassle of going down there and doing it. There's nothing that makes you incompetent when you do anything like that. It's clearly a ruse to try to take people's guns.
Yeah, well, the thing is, that's the interesting thing that too. But the thing is, that actually makes you super competent more than incompetent. But thing I'm thinking about is we get somebody like Gunners of America and some of the other people get together and get a class action suit going against that arrangement. So that
I agree. It's a real problem, and I haven't heard very many candidates talk about the reality that we have these bureaucracies that have gone off and become their own little fiefdoms, doing whatever they wish. In so many cases, just like we've seen with the TPP, we see that the Congress has abdicated its authority to write laws. They'll go out and they'll create something, and then like the EPA, for example, and then they will turn over legislative abilities to the EPA. They will let them go after people, have their own law enforcement, quote unquote, so they can write the laws, they can do the law enforcement, and even have their own courts where you are considered to be guilty until proven innocent. And that's the problem with these bureaucratic findings. They go out, they write the laws without any input from Congress, and then you go to their little legislative or administrative hearings where you don't have a presumption of innocence. That's the way the IRS works too, isn't it? They all work like that.
Yeah.
And it's because the government, the Congress has abdicated that authority. Now they're getting ready to do that in a major, major way with the Trans-Pacific Partnership. That's the thing that is really scary about that, because as Senator Sessions, and he has been the one on the Republican side who has been the most outspoken about it. We've had several people on the Democrat side. There's only really two people on the Republican side that have opposed this, and that's Senator Sessions and Rand Paul. Senator Sessions has spoken the most about it, and he says that what it's going to create is a transnational governance. It's going to have a council that is going to be able to change this. Once it passes, it's going to come to our Congress. They're not going to be able to make any changes to this, any amendments to this, after it comes to them from this secret negotiation with corporate lawyers. And then once it's passed, this transnational committee can change it at will. It will be a living document, as he's pointed out, a very dangerous thing. But we've already seen this within the federal government, how they abdicate their authority to these different legislative bodies. Thank you so much, Jim. Stay with us. We're going to take some more phone calls, people that are on hold when we come back from break. For those of you who are leaving us now, we have Don't Miss the Nightly News tonight at 7 Central, 8 p.m. Eastern. If you're not supporting us with a membership, please consider doing that. We'll be right back for those who are following us on the internet, and we'll take more of your calls. Stay with us. We're going to go into overdrive for one segment to try to take some of the people who've been waiting to talk. Let's go right away to Wild in Wisconsin. You want to talk about Planned Parenthood, it says. Go ahead.
Hi, Mr. Knight. I was wondering if there's any information on to where these tissue samples are going outside of the scientific realm.
I don't know. I know that STEM Express was involved in that. That's part of the injunction that they got to try to stop this. STEM Express said, we don't want to see our employees in this. And I don't really know what the legal argument from that judge was. I don't see why there would be any reason to censor that. But of course, that's the other part of the question, isn't it? And that is, it's not just the people who are supplying this, but what is drawing this in? What are the uses that this is being put to? What do you think? Do you have any ideas on that?
I think the ideas are pretty nefarious, as it seems that it's already designed to be a illegal business, and any businesses that are illegal or done in the shadows are done for a reason. Yeah. I have also been curious on if it's been done since the foundation of that organization. We're talking about metric tons, aren't we?
I don't know what the quantity is, but I'm sure it's a lot. It's a lot of money. I certainly know that. And I know that even if it's something that is done for the good of humanity, and we hear that argument all the time, that was the argument that Josef Mengele and others made when they were operating and doing horrific things to people in German concentration camps, things that people were having done to them in Japanese concentration camps, prisoners of war. We don't authorize experimentation on humans. We don't take human life under the argument that we can make life better for other people. We also don't take informed consent if we're going to have any kind of ethics. But of course, we see bills all across the United States taking away our informed consent, saying that we must be forced to have vaccines under this idea of herd immunity. And we've talked about that many times. But that's where we are today. An absolute contempt for informed consent, a contempt for the dignity and the life of humans. And that's fundamentally the aspect. There isn't anything, I agree with you, Wild, there isn't anything that we could use this for that would justify this. I don't see any justification whatsoever for it. Real quickly, I want to move on to some others who've been waiting. Kevin in Florida. Go ahead, Kevin.
Thank you, David. I just wanted to get your take on the Canada situation. I know earlier you discussed about not trying to put all your eggs in one candidate's basket. However, I believe that we're going to be seriously, seriously in trouble if Rand Paul doesn't get in, because my view is he's the only candidate who's going to try and get rid of the Federal Reserve, get rid of the IRS, and all sorts of other things, take back our rights, allow us to have guns, get the government out of everything that we do.
Well, I agree with you. I think Rand Paul is talking about a lot of issues that the other candidates have avoided for a very long time, just like his father talked about the Federal Reserve, something nobody else would talk about. His candidacy, even though we saw from the Ron Paul candidacy the massive corruption in the election system, especially in the primary system of the GOP, even though we saw that, his candidacy was candidacy was very important because it educated so many people about the private Federal Reserve. And nobody is talking about civil liberties. Nobody's talking about the surveillance state except for Rand Paul. There's not any other Republican that doesn't support a massive interventionist policy. And yet we see things like Politico where they're saying, well, what happened to Rand Paul? His campaign is spiraling down. It hasn't even started yet. We're going to have the first dog and pony show tonight for all of this stuff. But if you want to look at polls, if you want to look at the horse race stuff, look at what they have at Real Clear Politics. That's a cross section of a lot of different polls. If you want to play the polling game, the horse race game, Rand Paul does better than any other Republican against Hillary Clinton. That's a fact. There's not anybody else that does that if you average those polls together. And if you want to not play the game of selectively looking at data, then do that. But I think it's far too soon to start looking at the horse race aspect. We need to focus on the issues. And we need people like Rand Paul who are going to talk about issues that nobody else is talking about. Thanks for joining us. Join us again tomorrow at 11 Central. For